a very esteemed and distinguished scholars from different parts of the country as well as from abroad, and especially Professor Sachin Chaturvedi ji, who in fact gave his time to come and address the inaugural address he agreed to deliver. In fact, after listening to such a brilliant introductory remarks by the director, I don't have much to add except that, you know, after the Second World War, a number of countries became free from the colonial rule. So in that sense, we can say that we did get the political freedom, the territorial freedom, political independence. We did receive, and therefore you can say that we became a sovereign country. But did we really become a sovereign country? That is a big question. Because political and territorial freedom is not all. And therefore I'm saying that we were thinking that, you know, Swarajya is not unidimensional in nature. Swarajya is multi-dimensional kind of a concept. And we have been focusing so far mainly on the political aspects of Swarajya. The economic Swaraj is needed, cultural Swaraj, which in fact was over dominated and overlapping, you know, in many senses. So do we have that achieved? And in fact, another, you know, the development that has taken place after the Second World War, and particularly in the 80s and 90s, was a movement towards globalization. So therefore, we started moving from the national concept to international concept of interdependence. So has it really blunted the desire for Swaraj? Has it really dominated our minds? So therefore, have we really got free from the colonial kind of models? And here I would like to draw your attention to the fact that Pandit Deendayal Upadhyay, when he in fact delivered 4 lectures, and he came to the theory of integral humanism. In fact, this concept of multidimensionality of Swaraj comes out very clearly in that in those 4 lectures. And he questioned the different economic models of development, and not only economic models of development, but also he in fact was sending a message that we must have a holistic approach to development, the cultural development, the economic development, the human development, and whatnot. So therefore, man to develop must have a kind of a holistic approach to development. That is what Pandit Deendayal Upadhyay in fact talked about. And I think that it is high time that we must include in our studies of Swaraj and ideas as to what are the other dimensions apart from politics. And even Gandhiji, Veer Savarkar, and Jayaprakash Narayan, they also use the term Swaraj in different ways, in their own ways. And mostly though they confine themselves to the political discussions of Swaraj, but many other aspects were also impliedly and implicitly referred to by the modern Indian thinkers as well. So therefore, I'm happy that we are organizing this very important national integration meeting, which is 3rd in number. And we hope that we shall come to some very concrete and important conclusions. I have a proud privilege to welcome you all once again. Professor Makarand Pranjpe has already expressed his gratitude. So therefore, without standing between you and Professor Chaturvedi, I would request Professor Chaturvedi to kindly deliver the inaugural address. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, Professor Sharma, Honorable Member of Parliament, Shri Rakesh Sinha ji, Director of the Indian Institute of Advanced Studies, Professor Makarand Paranjpe, Professor Rajveer Sharma. Let me at the outset congratulate you and the team for this excellent theme that you have chosen. And as Professor Makran Paranjapi very rightly said, this is a samvad and it would go on. So it's not one time seminar that we are doing. It's a dialogue that would go on. And I think that Vaicharik Swaraj is extremely important component of the new development strategy that we need to think of. And I think I should also congratulate the team and Professor Sharma, you for this excellent concept note that has emerged. And I think reminding all of us of Professor Krishnachandra Bhattacharya and director and his initial remarks alluded to that, I think is absolutely important. The five stages that have come, and in fact, I would urge IAS to publish that special issue of the journal that you have referred. Probably that debate has to be brought out again to remind all of us who are here to discuss this important dimension. I think one of them is about language, Paranjapay ji ne bahut achha kaha ki paradhin se swatantra ki aur jab hum jaate hain ya hum jab hindvi swaraj mein tilak ki baat karte hain to hamara prayas swaprakash se ujjwalit hone ki taraf hai, us atmabodh ki taraf hai. तो वो सिर्फ बातें ही नहीं रह जाएं और हम कुछ सब्सटेंटिव काम करें और अपने अपने क्षेत्रों में उन कॉन्सेप्ट्स को विकसित करने का प्रयास करें जो कि स्वराज की तरफ हमें विचारों के माध्यम से ले जा सकता है. तो मुझे लगता है कि आज जो मैं थीम मन में सोच रहा था उसका बहुत अच्छा जिक्र प्रोफेसर राजवी शर्मा जी ने किया ग्लोबलाइजेशन और होलिस्टिक डेवलपमेंट से. तो मैं कुछ बातें आप लोगों के सामने रखना चाहता हूं और मैं सोच रहा था कि उसको एक पावर पॉइंट के माध्यम से रखूं जिससे कि जो हमारा चर्चा का सत्र है वो सधा हुआ रहे और मैं भी समय सीमा में अपनी बात पूरी कर सकूं. तो इसलिए मैंने पावर पॉइंट में कुछ बातें रखने का प्रयास किया है. बाद में उसको लिख करके हम और चर्चा में उस बात को लेके आ सकते हैं. मुझे ऐसा लग रहा था कि जिस इंडियन सिविलाइजेशनल इथॉस की और प्रैक्टिस की हम बात करते हैं वो एक हद तक काफी इस मामले में महत्वपूर्ण है कि हम वर्ल्ड के साथ अपने आप को कैसे देखते हैं. तो कुछ कॉन्सेप्ट्स अब ऐसे निकल के आ रहे हैं वैश्विक स्तर पे जो हमारी अपनी पारंपरिक विकास की जो सोच है उससे मैच करते हैं. तो अगर हम देखें कि जिस सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंट गोल, और मैंने इसी का उदाहरण लिया है क्योंकि अभी आप देखेंगे कि विश्व की तमाम आर्थिक व्यवस्थाएं, अभी G7 देशों का सम्मेलन हुआ उसमें भी SDGs की बात हुई, यूनाइटेड नेशंस भी SDG की लगातार बात कर रहा है, ये आखिरी डिकेड है 2030 तक पहुंचने का. तो दे हैव बीन टॉकिंग अबाउट 5 P's विच आर पीपल प्लैनेट प्रॉस्पेरिटी पीस एंड पार्टनरशिप. और हमारे पारंपरिक सोच में ये कैसा है इसके बारे में मैं चर्चा करूंगा. लेकिन जो स्ट्रेटेजी सोची गई यूनाइटेड नेशंस के द्वारा 2012 में और 2015 में जब SDG लागू हुए तो उन्होंने उसमें कहा कि इकोनॉमिक पॉलिटिकल एंड सोशल ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन, तो ट्रिपल ट्रांजिशन होना चाहिए जो कि इकोनॉमिक हो, पॉलिटिकल हो और सोशल हो. और वो 5 P's को एड्रेस करते हुए क्या गया और उसके साथ मिलेनियम डेवलपमेंट गोल से हम सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंट गोल की तरफ आगे बढ़े. तो जब ये आगे बढ़ने का की प्रक्रिया हुई तो उन पांचों तत्वों को जो कि प्लैनेट है, प्रोस्पेरिटी है, पीस है और पार्टनरशिप और पीपल के माध्यम से वो जुड़े. तो इस कॉन्सेप्ट में हम देखते हैं कि कई सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंट गोल्स आ गए. वैसे तो 17 गोल्स हैं. 17 गोल्स को अगर हम दो लाइन में कहना चाहें तो जो 1 से 7 तक के गोल्स हैं वो वही गोल हैं जो मिलेनियम डेवलपमेंट गोल्स में थे. 8 से 10 गोल नंबर के वो हैं जो कि डेवलपमेंट के इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स हैं और 11 से 17 वो गोल्स हैं जो सस्टेनेबिलिटी के लिए हमें फ्रेमवर्क देते हैं. तो इस तरह से एक हुआ. एक इस स्लाइड में मेरी कोशिश ये थी कि मैं ये बता सकूं कि गोल जो है अपने आप में इंडिपेंडेंट नहीं है, सब एक दूसरे से जुड़े हुए हैं और आगे जो मैं पॉइंट कहने वाला हूँ उसका इससे बड़ा संबंध है. जैसे कि मैंने एक उदाहरण लिया, गोल नंबर 2 जो है वो एग्रीकल्चर के ऊपर है. तो अब जो बचे हुए गोल हैं वो अपने आप में अलग नहीं है, वो इस SDG के जो गोल नंबर 2 है उससे जुड़े हुए हैं. तो अगर आप एग्रीकल्चर में कोई कार्यवाही करते हैं, कोई नया कार्यक्रम लेके आते हैं, तो वो पॉवर्टी को गोल नंबर एक जो है, पानी को गोल नंबर छह है, गोल नंबर सात जो एनर्जी है, तो पीछे के दशकों में विकास की एक ऐसी यात्रा रही, डेवलपमेंट हैज बीन सच दैट वी हैव सीन आवर ग्रोथ एंड स्ट्रेटजीज फॉर ग्रोथ इन अ वेरी फ्रेगमेंटेड मैनर. So we lost out what Professor Rajvi Sharma was saying in terms of that holistic development. And this is very clear from the commentary that Deen Dayal ji gave for the second five-year plan. So that fragmentation which happened over the years and happened with the full consent and support of the institutions that followed Washington consensus and provided that fragmentation as a growth strategy, and India also accepted that, forgetting all in the past that we were thinking of and talking about. There are several very, very accomplished names that are here with us today who are going to talk to us about how we looked at the process in Vedic Prashtabhumi and also in Sanskrit other texts, Professor Deepthi Tripathi and Professor Shishi Prabha Kumar. They would tell us how in the historic times we really had that comprehensive integrated view of our development strategy, which we lost out, and now sustainable development goals are talking about that. And so were the definitions which came up, be that by the Brundtland Commission or by others, where they tried to capture the differences that were there in terms of how the process would look like. In Indian philosophy, if we look at the dimensions have been in terms of how the central pivot has been dharma. And that we somehow lost out to our directive principles. And these directive principles actually talked about a role. But if you look at our ancient concept of a citizen, then the duty was uppermost in minds of those who were making public policy at that point. So as Professor Makran Paranjapi so eloquently described this process of our linkages with the wider processes of Atma Bodh, I think the idea of harmonized relation between Kama and Artha, that the duty-bound structures for Dharma came in, that gives the gravitas for us to connect. And that's the philosophy that takes us to the concepts like this, where you are trying to imagine one world and you're trying to envisage welfare of all. And this is largely the crux of the Sustainable Development Goal, because what India is doing with the Bay of Bengal or Indian Ocean is affecting not only Sri Lanka and Maldives, but it also affects Nepal and Bhutan, because the kind of rains that they are going to get would be very much dependent on this water cycle that is happening. So one action can not be unidirectional alone. It would be multidimensional. So the idea of multidimensional development is very much imbibed in the prayers and the ideas that we came up with. And that's where the concept of Earth and the Earth sciences that we are talking of now, the oceans that we are talking of now, were very much part of the larger conceptual frameworks with which we thought at some point was the religious text. But that was, I think, in my view, a very much public policy guideline, which in the interim period we lost out. And after independence in 47, we did not try to connect back with what we lost out in terms of continuum of that knowledge flow. And this is where I see in terms of how we can connect with everyone. We are talking of vaccine diplomacy or vaccine maitri. This is very much part of the idea that we had in terms of providing linkages. So sustainable development goals are our partnerships. As I said, goal 17 is about partnership. And this is our sort of philosophy and idea which gives the basis for that. And this is in terms of the nutritional security and for food security. So the Millennium Development Goals and Sustainable Development Goals are largely different in that framework. The Millennium Development Goals talked about food security. And now in the Sustainable Development Goals, we are talking about nutritional security. So we are emphasizing on the point of quality rather than quantity. So we do not need too many schools. We need quality education. So we do not need too much of food. We need quality, nutritious food. So this idea that has evolved over the years is something which is extremely important. But SDG is not everything. SDG has missing links as well. And in this, I would very much like to emphasize on the point that, again, we are imbibing, because the debate in West is also realizing the limitation of the development frameworks they have come up with. So Mr. Hawks and many others are now saying that the cultural vitality is as essential as a healthy and sustainable society. So what is happening in the triple helix of environment, political and economic, the trinity that I talked about earlier in the slide, the fourth element is coming in. And this fourth element, which cuts across social, economic and environmental dimension, is culture. Now, if you look at the contemporary economic literature for last 15 years, it's full with literature on why economists have given up the idea of culture in their measurement. If you look at Adam Smith, the classical economist, they did talk about moral science, they did talk about ethics, and when they talk about wealth of nations, they do intertwine the arguments with moral sentiments. The system of logic of J.S. Mill regarded cultural constraints as more important than even the pursuit of personal interest. And we know Karl Marx's idea of cultural hegemony, and then he got into the technology role in terms of dominating the idea of that landscape. And this continued in terms of how the current thinking in economic literature emerged more from Chicago School of Monetarists, who completely sidelined the idea of what is not measurable is not something that can be captured in economic theory. And as a result, we lost out, and we saw what happened in 2008 with the Great Recession, that the moral compass of the financial system was completely at stake. And as a result, what happened, we all saw it. So the institutional economists are now trying to say that you cannot say that there should be election commission. Election commission in India, election commission in Ghana, and election commission in Pakistan cannot be the same entities. What determines the vitality and vibrancy of institutions is the culture. So people have to have the institutional frameworks which are embedded in the cultural context. So we are talking about institutions, and now economic theories are very clear that if countries do not have institutions, economic development is impossible. But you cannot transplant institutions until and unless you understand the local context of culture. And that's what we need to understand, and we need to measure. In the Europe now, a lot of measurements are on in terms of creativity. In fact, this is the year when United Nations is celebrating as International Year of Creative Economy for Sustainable Development. So they are trying to see that the local culture with psychology, sociology, and economy, they are extremely important. Esimoglu studies that came out, he's a Turkish economist based in US, who has come out with n number of studies on how institutional economics should look at. But if you look at Balan and others, they have tried to bring out the fact that economic development and institutions become effective only when you have the local context of culture. So this is largely the point that I'm trying to make in terms of how we look at the dimension of development, and how the local idea of development bereft of cultural connect would have no meaning. So if World Bank and IMF are providing us the roadmap of 1991 economic reforms of this country, no surprise that we lost out on the research strength of Indian Council of Agriculture Research, the dependence on knowledge for multinational corporations, and complete squeeze of small and medium enterprises in last 20 years is a mega issue. And I am so glad that Professor Paranjpe alluded to Modi Kal in terms of how startups and others are now becoming new instruments for bringing in the great support that we need for these sectors. And unfortunately, we have lost a lot of time after that, almost 20, 30 years, but we need to revive that. The idea of participation of all in development for all is a reflection of what now Sustainable Development Goal is saying, and it said in 2015 of no one should be left behind. And even before that, in India, we were talking about this participation of all in development for all. So that context now is getting revived and is getting connected with the Gandhian philosophy of Sarvodaya. And the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, the Mudra scheme, etc., are the manifestations of these new endeavors, which are trying to bring the idea of Swaraj embedded and connected with the concept of Swadeshi. So this idea, I think, is important, and we need to understand how the process of globalization that we have witnessed in recent times has unbundled. Richard Baldwin is one of the leading global economists who has come up with some theories of how globalization actually happens. So if you look at the process, we find that trade is the major instrument. So whenever any country would seek support from IMF or World Bank, they would be asked to open up. And we got several economists who were saying liberalization is the only way forward, and we have to talk about liberalization. As a result, trade expanded. Exports and imports both rose all across various countries. And information communication technology and other technological chains, they became part of this process. So what Richard Baldwin says is that globalization is basically a process of unbundling. And this unbundling, he says, happens in three different stages. The first unbundling, he says, happened when the cost of moving goods fell. So transport technologies improved in the process that fostered the process. And that was the time when industrial revolution happened. The second is more in terms of unbundling, which led to sort of global value chains coming in and trying to get a lot of products. So like for Adidas shoes, the upper is being made in Thailand, the base is being made in China, the shoes are branded from US and are being marketed in India. So this is what he said is the second unbundling. The third unbundling, he says, would be more what we are seeing right now under lockdown situation, where face-to-face costs would plunge, and we would just be talking to people through screen, which is happening now. And he says the technology would be so that you don't need even computer brain waves would happen, and they would be actually communicating, which we have discussed in our literature extremely well. The idea in terms of how the book A Third Way came out, which was titled as Global Economic System and the Hindu View, that book by the Tupantengri became one of the landmarks in 1995 when the book was published. It talked about the idea, the theory and production facilities that India stands for and how we look at that process. The idea of one world that we stand for, that is what precisely Sustainable Development Goals are all for. And they are in terms of responsible global citizenry, which is nothing but Vasudev Kutumbakam. So the idea is intertwined with our concept of genuine globalization. So how we look at the process of globalization is important. I already shared with you the concept of welfare for all. And the recent studies, particularly in science and nature, they have brought out this fact of how human-centric development has moved ahead, which is a catastrophe for other species on the earth. And these have devastated ecosystems. And we are seeing that in this process, a chemical balance in the oceans has gone haywire. And we have lost a lot of wellness that is needed in our oceans with other species. And that process is largely in terms of the delicate balance between nature, humans, and development. And that process requires how we bring in the maximizing happiness concept of the current Washington consensus and its related growth theories. So if Swaraj of Ideas is not connecting our past knowledge base with our growth and development strategy, we would be too late, and we would be too late to correct this imbalance that is coming out from monetarist school of Chicago that has given Washington consensus and the growth and development paradigm. We are still running out of GDP steam in terms of sustaining a comprehensive development strategy. Our economists who are sitting in the planning process would have to disconnect themselves with this obsession with the gross domestic product. We need to see how a 5 points for development model are important. And in my view, according to our traditional civilizational Sanatan Dharma Sanskriti, we have 5 points for development theory and model, and that is ethics and politics. So politics and ethics have to remain embedded with each other, and they would provide basis for solid economic development model, which brings in justice and humanity. That connect has to come in on the basis of culture and ecology. So these 5 principles are interconnected, interdependent, and energize each other when we evolve our development and growth model. If we are devoid of any one of them, we are going to end up with a complete failure on bringing everyone along with us. And that's where the question of access, equity, and inclusion comes in. Lot of technologies are coming in. We need to see whether those technologies are really providing access, like for instance, vaccine. Do they provide equity? Do they provide inclusion? And this applies to the idea of ethics and governance. And that's where all the new concepts we would have to see when we talk about semiconductor industry and others that are going in. So what we are seeing in terms of distinction between Indian civilizational ethos and Western development model. And as an economist, I see more sort of contestations coming in terms of value-based competition and cooperation, economic equality and opportunity, trying to bring in nature only to milk it and not to exploit it, trying to bring in self-employment, which is very much the startup and other programs, how to bring in support mechanisms for children and senior citizens or those who are handicapped, and trying to balance between decentralization and centralization, appropriate technologies, and self-reliance and not self-sufficiency. And this is what would lead us to the idea of Antyodaya. It is also in terms of bringing in, as I said earlier, the balance that is needed between earth and karma. And that's where we have to make an effort how to bring them as part of the development and growth theory. They are very good on slides. They are very good in public lectures, and people would feel very happy when we talk about the acquisitiveness versus aparigraha. But how to turn that into economic policy? And that's where our contribution would come in. And the idea which I mentioned right in the beginning, that it's not right-oriented, the rights-oriented consciousness of the duties, but also duty-oriented consciousness of others' rights. So that, I think, is something which is trying to bring in happiness for not just oneself, but for all and for the society. So in my view, the way forward, and as I see, I'm crossing my time, is in terms of Vaicharik Swaraj. When we talk about, we need to see that we do not propose to close the windows outside. We are trying to see the idea of one world. We are trying to see local connect. We are trying to see knowledge production, ownership, and the frameworks that are there. We are trying to see the flexibility and formalization. So what Professor Makran Paranjape was saying in terms of Atma Bodh and so Prakash Ujwalit direction. I think the academics from different knowledge streams would have to make this effort in terms of new meanings and new experiences in our knowledge streams. University Grants Commission, Indian Council for Social Science and Research, and other such institutions would have to see that they create space for defining a syllabus in a different way. How we create alternative knowledge centers, and IIS can provide a huge crucible for generation of this knowledge. Even the idea of Bharat and India that provides modernity but rationality and the scientific purpose that is needed for Ek Bharat and Shreshth Bharat. Recently, Dr. Jaishankar made a very important point when he was responding to the Article 370 debate, when he said that in Asia, nationalism is a positive word. And we need to see that the Western designs and descriptions of nationalism and rise of nationalist tendencies in India, which very often is on the front pages of Wall Street Journal and Financial Times and the New York Times. I don't think we need to bother too much about it until unless we are very sure of what we are doing. And that's where I think the last slide that I want to bring in here is in terms of the effort that we are trying to make. And I think Swarajan ideas is very important in terms of the 5 points that the excellent concept note for this conference has provided. I'm sure across various sessions, we would be able to capture code, institution, content, medium, and agency. We need to think in terms of how development model, for instance, the topic that I picked up for today's discussion, may bring in policy and practice convergence in terms of the new mindsets that are needed for our development theory, how the development should look like, and how we connect with the past knowledge and the bandwidth that is needed to identify the drivers. What kind of institutions can really play, and what kind of research institutions we need to reorient in this country to contribute to the new institutional reforms that are needed, and how the research and teaching can really be encouraged to go on the path of Swaraj, and for that, what kind of changes in syllabus we need, and what kind of discussions we need. Because if you are changing the syllabus, the alternatives should be equally rigorous. They need to bring in the vigor, they need to bring in the academic credentials that are needed for having that as part of the syllabus. Local languages, of course, are increasing. Civil society is identified in the concept note. I would very much think of academics to start playing that role, and I'm so much optimistic about this new role that Professor Paranjape has talked about and has discussed in terms of we discussing and bringing out the new ideas that are needed to go ahead with this conference. With these words, I once again very warmly greet IIS for this excellent initiative and thank them profusely for giving me this opportunity. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. That was a very wide-ranging and comprehensive presentation, and you brought in some really important ideas in our quest for Atmanirbhar Bharat. You said very correctly that without the ideas of Purusharth, the four Purusharths, and how you link that with the UN development goals, and indeed the climate crisis and the economic crisis in the world, which is in a way exacerbated because apart from karma and artha, we are forgetting dharma, which also includes self-restraint when it comes to consumption, when it comes to production, when it comes to exploitation of the earth. You talked about the Anthropocene, how humans are only thinking about humans when the planet belongs to all. And though you didn't talk about moksha, I think Professor Raju has joined. He'll always say moksha came later. We only had Trivarga. I completely agree. Whatever and however it came in is a different matter. But the fact is that without some notion of human flourishing, which transcends the physical satisfaction of our needs, if you don't have a notion of human flourishing which transcends, exceeds human, I mean, exceeds the satisfaction of physical needs, you may call it Jivan Mukti, Moksha, whatever you may call it, Kaivalya, Nirvana, but a trans-physical notion of human flourishing. Without that, I don't think you can have notions of moksha or beyond a point restraint or even preserving the planet for the next generation. And I'm glad you brought in the third way of Dattopanta Thengadi ji. I remember in his first few pages, he mentions Victor Hugo. And if I remember right, I mean, I was a young, much younger when I read that book. He mentions, you know, he quotes Victor Hugo and he says, there is nothing so terrible as the birth of an idea whose time has come. So we are going through this terrible time when the birth of new ideas has grabbed us by the throat. There's a lot of discomfort among entrenched sections, whoever these be, but we have to move forward. And I really appreciate how you mentioned an integral, holistic notion of development, which Professor Rajvi Sharma also mentioned. Swarajya is a multidimensional concept, as Professor Rajvi ji said. It is not just political Swarajya. It is not just economic Swarajya. And when it comes to economic Swarajya, as you rightly said, Atmanirbhar doesn't mean you make everything in your backyard. I mean, the world is so integrated and unbundled. And when we speak about education, COVID has, in a way, unbundled brick and mortar knowledge transmission completely. Now, this is a great opportunity for us, you see. And this centralized educational policy oriented learning outcomes, we have to go beyond that. And 12th class exams have been canceled. So we must allow each institution greater autonomy in making its own selections so that one exam cannot be a be all and end all for a person's entire life. Okay, boss, you didn't make it. You didn't get so many marks. You will never make it to economics in Sri Ram College or St. Stephen's College because you didn't get 99.3. Obviously, the future of our children cannot be determined by this kind of centralized, in fact, planning, etc. I don't think Swarajya is about centralization at all. Swarajya is about an energy which is transformative, which informs the entire body politic, and in which every individual, the Praja, is empowered, not just the Raja. The Raja is a facilitator. Anyhow, I see that Dr. Rakesh Sinhaji has joined, and we will have a discussion later if time permits. I'm very grateful to you, Dr. Rakesh Sinha. I don't know how to introduce you, but I'll just say one word. He is the leading intellectual in the so-called right-wing circles. Now, why I say this is not because of what he has written. He has written many books, but because he thinks. Ye sachmuch ek chintak hai. If you go to his house, you'll find five books open in five different places. His mind is active. He's constantly engaging with ideas. You can see that in his columns. They are not predictable. They are not towing the party line alone. And even when he was spokesman, he would always bring in another dimension. You know, I don't know anybody who has written and who has researched equally incisively and extensively both the Communist Party of India and Dr. G, that is Keshav Baliram Hedgewarji. I don't know anybody who has done both these things, one individual, equally incisively. Agar dusre koi hai, to mujhe bataya jaye, but mere knowledge mein to nahi hai. So with these few words, I welcome you, sir. Thank you for joining us. You're a member of parliament. Your time is very precious and it's dedicated to the nation. That you could spare some of it for us is a matter of great honor for us. Thank you. Over to you, sir.
Dear Professor Makarand Rajpayee, Director of the Institute, Professor Rajveer Sharma ji, who is convener of this seminar, and Professor Sachin Chaturvedi ji, and all distinguished participants. After listening Ranjpiji, Rajbir ji and Sachin Chaturvedi ji, I don't find any word to add in this discourse. Still, I have to speak something. Therefore, I remember 8th century thinker Santi Deva. He wrote a book, and in the preface he wrote that nothing new will be said, nor have I any skill of composition. Therefore, I do not imagine that I can benefit others. I have done to improve my own mind. So I think whatever we speak in terms of improving our own mind and a kind of interaction with the distinguished audience, so that at the end of the day, we achieve something which is substantive not for the present, but also for the posterity. Therefore, I consider that our every word and action is not to address the past of which we are hires and the present in which we are acting, but also for the future for which our posterity will be the possessors. Therefore, whatever ideology, whatever the our bracketing, we must keep in mind that we owe responsibility to the future and the posterity. This topic, decolonization, has a vast dimension. And I think the question of decolonization or Asian countries, there are certain commonalities, but there are fundamental differences. The question of decolonization as far as Indian context is concerned, it is not the same which is for Africa and other Asian countries. I will come on later, but say about decolonization, then we lost in the ideas. They're subjective ideas. And the people who follow us, they don't get anything substantive, where to begin, how to begin, what to do. These are three questions before the new generations who are in graduation, who are in post-graduation, who are doing MPhil, who are doing PhD. Therefore, we should deliberate something concrete for them. So I do that. Where did we fail in decolonizing? I just mentioned Ngugi, who is a Kenyan thinker. He was one of the first, and Professor Pranjipe is also from India, is one of the very rare authors and writers and thinkers who have seriously deliberated on the question of decolonization. I have read his books. And I find that just like that, one place he writes that there should not be difference between aesthetics and ideology, both are interconnected. I found a lot of, this is a very pregnant idea. Therefore, I consider that whatever I am speaking before the distinguished panelists and the participants, there are few words. I am starting that Ngugi. What Ngugi says is the mind. Coming to this subject, Ngugi was a great novelist. He used to write in English.
Yahi to anand hai, isliye humne apne ko camera band kar diya.
In 1976, he changed his name from Michael Ngugi to Ngugi Wa Thiong Po. What was the reason? The reason is that he found that not only the difference between the two set of rulers after the liberation, but he found the difference in two set of values. The values he imposed on Africa had not been cherished by Africans for centuries. The Ubuntu, you are because I am because you are, the question of coexistence. Here he said that colonizers are just like a cultural bomb. They come, and as a cultural bomb, they annihilate a people's belief in their names, in their environment, in their capacity. And this annihilation obliterates their identity. That's why I decided not to write in English and I started writing in Kenyan language, Kikuyu. But this is a small matter that whenever we discuss these things, this get imprisoned in the question of language. There's of course importance of language. Language is a carrier of culture and it is correlated with the culture. But the decolonization is far ahead. The agenda of decolonization should not be stopped on the question of language. Language is one of the criteria, one of the parameters, or one of the major things, but this is not a sine qua non in any debate and discourse. Even if we consider that another thinker I'm talking who has spoken very extensively on decolonization is Franz Fanon. Although he was a Marxist thinker, but he raised a very fundamental question that colonization is not a thinking, imperialism or colonialism is not a thinking machine. It is a violence in the natural state. And when he said violence in natural state, I just see the Indian situation. I'm just raising an issue that in Indian Rajya Sabha, G. Ramchandra on 19th August 1959, raised the question. The question was why the statues of King George, Queen Victoria, Edward King were still on Indian soil. This question was raised in 1959, 12 years after the independence. The minister replied that on a given time, appropriate time, we remove the statues. The second question, a decade after, on 5th March 1969, Dattopant Thengri raised that there were symbols of British imperialism on the North and South blocks, the seat of India's sovereign authorities. Again, the minister said, we are thinking to remove that. We got independence in 47, and the question was raised in 1969. This is not very important question. This is symbolically important. I am deliberating these things because why this becomes constitute an important dimensions in the history of decolonization as symbol as far symbolism is concerned. Someone contests that these are symbolic things. I also consider symbolic things. But here I connect with Franz Fanon. You know, on 11th August 9th, who were they? Queen Victoria, Edward King, or King George? Whom they represented? What values they represented? What did they do with India or any colony? I will give just two and three instances. On 11th August 1942, out of seven martyrs who were moving towards the Patna Secretariat in Bihar to unfurl the tricolor, six were ninth class students: Har Gobind, Ramanand, and his four other colleagues. Only one boy was from 11th class. W.G. Archer was the district collector. He ordered to shoot all of them. Their sacrifice ended that they unfurled the flag. But this is not the one exceptional incident of the colonial rule. Next day, on 12th August 1942, 13 unarmed freedom fighters were shot down in Assam. I will take two names. Baji Raut, she was only 12 years old. And Talasri Barua, 12 years old. Talasri Barua from Assam, Baji Raut from Orissa, both were killed by the British police. Then Vasishtha Kumar Mehta is age of 15 and Kanak Lata Barua as the age of 17. They sacrificed their lives. Why they killed the small children? Why they killed the teenagers? Because they realized that the thinking mind of a teenager is a challenge to the British imperialism. So this was a clash between the thinking mind and the mind which wanted to freedom, liberty. Therefore, this question becomes very important that the people who succeeded the British rulers, why they behave like a lazy decolonizers? I consider them the willful subordinates of the British colonialism. I will take other name of Sundaraiah, P. Sundaraiah was a Communist Party member, and in the Rajya Sabha, he raised the question of India's membership of Commonwealth. A large number of people, members, agreed with P. Sundaraiah that India should not be part of the Commonwealth. So these were issues. These issues have not germinated in a vacuum. There are two more important instances. One was that India's sterling reserve was more than 1300 million pounds and in India in 1945. But by 1949, India was not in the position to even get the 32 million pounds from the Britain. And negotiation continued till 1956 till Suez crisis took place. So the kind of manipulation by the British imperialism, which I find Dadabhai Nauroji latest work of Utsa Patnaik, that $45 trillion was plundered by the Britishers since 1765 to 1938. So these are the important questions which show that we fail to decode the transfer of power. We have decoded transfer of power in terms of two things. One, the freedom movement under Gandhi, which was a very important movement, supported by millions of the people, have faith in the leadership of Mahatma Gandhi. But that uncritical support and uncritical study of any movement is dangerous for any national society. Why was not there any representation of other point of view, other movements which were part of the anti-imperialist struggle? So the question is that decoding the freedom movement is very important, where we fail miserably. That this decoding requires that why Indian freedom movement and the African freedom movement have some differences. The African freedom movement was not merely a political movement. It was against imperialism. But at the same time, it raised the cultural questions. It raised the social questions. They fought against apartheid. They fought against the racialism. They fought against economic exploitation. They also spoke about their cultural identity, which we find reflection in Nagogi's thought. But India, the Indian National Congress, since 1885, to 1946, in its resolution, in the resolution of the Congress Party, you will not find two or three issues related to India's culture, India's society. Everything is related either economic and political. On the question of politics, we're more articulated, more organized. But on the question of economic, we are very much polemical. That's why, under the guise of constitutional dialogue, discussion, and constitutional reform, the Britishers continued plundering the people, common people. And the common people remain helpless under the coercion of the British rule on the one hand. On the other hand, the pressure of the non-violent political movement as a hegemonic movement of the Indian freedom movement. Therefore, I consider, without going to merit and demerit of any mode of the movement, we must decode the question of freedom struggle, its basis, its philosophical and fundamental arguments, and we must compare that. There are works, but I think the systematic work should be there. Second important thing where we fail. British colonialism, while transfer of power, they have cheated India on the question of our economic well-being. That has remained unraveled. There are works, and they are the scattered work about the British imperialism. That needs the transfer of power itself needs to be critically analyzed. And that critical analysis would produce the alternative viewpoint and the viewpoint which would be in a general discourse of the coming generation and also the present. But the question of decolonization, that question of decolonization is one dimension, and when I find that subalterns are raising the issue of post-colonial discourse in others like Gayatri Chakravarti Spivak or Homi Bhava or Dipesh Chakravarti, they are doing good work. But the question is not that they are questioning the Europe's hegemony. They are questioning the Europe's domination on the former colonies on the plane of idea. But is it enough? I think whatever they are doing, despite their good work, impactful work, they are not enough. They are just like one dimension. And that's why I say that the question of decolonization is different from the question of decolonization in Africa and Latin America. I compared the both, and I found these are the commonalities where we have to do the decoding of transfer of power, decoding of the freedom movement, decoding of the leadership of the freedom movement. That is one aspect where we are common with Africa and Latin America. But beyond that, what was the situation before the Britishers came, and what is the situation after the Britishers left India? Can we compare India with other nations whose existence can be mapped in 1,000 years or 500 years or 300 years? India's existence cannot be comparable as a nation, as a civilization with other nations. That is a very significant point where we require to focus. This is the area where we need to work. We need to work not as a polemical, that worshipping just like Orientalists who worship India, and by worshipping India, they become antiquarian. What B.C. Pal called them, they are the academic antiquarian. The present is lacking in their writing. So I'm not talking of the Orientalism, that because Edward himself said that Orientalism is a European invention, largely European invention. And that helped Europe to define itself, to have its own experiences, and to make its image. So I'm not talking Orientalism. They have all limitations. Decolonization, Orientalism, post-colonial discourse. All three are bound by the European hegemonic ideas. They have not come out from that idea. So have you read any place that someone is talking about the Indian knowledge tradition, whether subalterns or post-colonialist or Orientalist? If they are talking, they are just mentioning as symbolic. I'm just giving examples of, I'm not talking of the Vedic period, but I'm just giving example of Nalanda University. Nalanda University was unparalleled in its contemporary world. It was unparalleled. There were 300 rooms, there were 8,000 students, 2,000 teachers, and the students from foreign countries, including China, were part of Nalanda University's campus. That university played a role 800 years. Contemporary era 425 to 1205, when Bakhtiar Khilji destroyed that. And the question is not that this only destruction. Why does Nalanda University was destroyed? Only because there was aggression, there was opposition. They came to Nalanda University, peaceful people, those who believed in diversities. There was a Mahayana section. There was also Brahmins, pandits discussing their own. So there were complete diversities in Nalanda University. Contestation was one of the important dimensions of Indian knowledge system. What was important that? There were 100 lectures every day taking place in Nalanda University. But have we done any work on Nalanda University? I got one book, The University of Nalanda, by Hansmukh D. Sakalia, that was published in 1934. In other places, like other authors, like those who wrote on the ancient Indian education, they have mentioned about Nalanda University just like a small event. A university of 800 years existence was destroyed, and not a single person was left. Everyone was killed. When Bhaktiyar Khilji wanted to know what were in the books, nobody was to explain. Eventually, the books were burnt. So the incident is not important. Important is what we lost. It is also not important the lost decades and lost centuries we carry. The things were lost, but we fail to recreate, reconstruct. So these are the lost decades and centuries. That is the failure. The Nalanda University was not only university. There was a Vallabhi University, which has center of Hinayan, and Vikramsila, which was Mahayan, Takshashila, which has 16 branches. Chanakya was related to Takshashila University. And there was a university in Amaravati, Sri Dhanya Katak University at the bank of Sipra River. So these were the university system in on our soil. And this university system indicates some kind of a system of knowledge which we define Indian knowledge tradition. That's why I'm telling you that, but this knowledge tradition could not be destroyed because this tradition exists in the mind of the people, not in the buildings, not only in the books. I'm just mentioning one, Nadia in Bengal. This emerged as a very important center, and some Western authors call it as a Oxford of India. That Nadia had three centers. Out of three centers, Nawadeep had the Kolkata Monthly on January 1791 mentioned that there were 6,000 students, 4,000 students, and 400 teachers in one of the centers. Geet Govindam of Jaydev. Yeah, they belong to that Nawadeep. So what is important is that, are we in the position to revive that tradition of knowledge? That tradition of knowledge is not some fundamental things which were in Nalanda University, Vikramsila or Nawadeep. The fundamental things are the features and basic characteristics of the education system. That characteristic of education system, I am mentioning very important thing was that the complete freedom to academics, the full freedom to academics, when there is a freedom to academic mind, when he can contest, when can he speak? And the presumption is that when he speaks and contests, that has some logic, that has some empiricism. It is not to provoke. Not to just for the sake of opposition. That became very important. That is one of the characteristics which gave Indian education system an evolutionary character that always evolved, always digested. So after that, when Britishers came, that's why Mahatma Gandhi in his 1931 lecture raised very important question, Royal Institute of International Affairs, 1931. He said that you have the beautiful tree perished. When he said that, it was an attack on the British imperialism that whatever we were left in the post-Mughal period, that was destroyed by you in the name of modern education. It is not that we don't require modern education, but we require whatever we have to study our system, our people, our custom from our own perspective, from own eyes, from our own tradition, which were destroyed. That's why when Nagogi says that the colonialism creates a watershed, that watershed that you start you start hating yourself. The heterogeneous develops in your own mind. You start imitating, and the language become important. Their culture become important. Their literature become important. So we find that in the present era of social science, most of the things, the narratives and counter narratives, come from Europe, and we are just add something. Just I call it a sophisticated plagiarism. We do the same. We hire the idea. They say that this is a modernism. We say modernism. They say postmodernism. We say postmodernism. I don't know what makes a change in them. Their own thinking changes, and they impose the entire thinking on the entire world. That is not acceptable. So decolonization goes far beyond that. Third thing where we fail is the most important thing that you recently Prime Minister spoke in Parliament and also the outside the Parliament. We also knowing that when Prime, it is important that Prime Minister use the forum of the Parliament to spread the message. India is a classical home of democracy. The existence of democracy is not related to the parliamentary democracy of Britain or Greeks or Athens or Sparta. We have not borrowed something from Rome, Greek, during the colonial time from the parliamentary democracy of Britain. Our democracy has a history. That history is a glorious history. I will not take much time on that, but this is important that K.P. Jaiswal was one of the few authors who dealt the issue. But how many of you, there are essays, there are writers, there are academic writers, but the systematic study of republics of India is missing. How can we start a deliberation in someone is going to Oxford or Harvard and giving a lecture that India is the oldest democracy? They would mock at us. They would laugh at us. Because it is not the polemical statement which proves the point. It is a hard, strenuous, and rigorous academic work, generation to generation, which gives you intellectual standing among the people of the world. Just by one good work or two good work cannot make us to compete the Americans and Europeans who claim the Roman state, who just project and what we deliberate about Plato, Aristotle. They were good thinkers. We should study that. It's not that Machiavelli should not be studied. It is not that Shakespeare should not be studied. We should study each and every thinker. This is the characteristic feature of India. That French fellow to Shakespeare, we should not be biased by our own mind. They may be biased, but we should not borrow. We should not imitate their biasness, their prejudice. Then our and their difference will be obliterated. What is important that Indian democracy, I am quoting Sukra. Means if Machiavelli would have said this has become very important part of our text. Sukra says that Rajya Brichaksya Nirpati Murlam Saskandha Sramcha Mantrina Sakha Sena Dipa Sena Padava Kusmanicha Praja Phalani Bhuvaga Bijam Bhumi Prakalpita, which means king is the root of tree of state. The ministry is its trunk. Military chiefs are branches. Army leaves of the tree. Subjects are flowers. Prosperity is fruits. And the whole country is a seed. This is this quote gives the democratic set of India, but this is not an isolated. If different period and different things took place, you know, in our literature, there is a concept of Dwiraj, which is known as Dyarchy. During the British rule, we know that there was Dyarchy in 1920s, which failed miserably. But our Dyarchy had not failed. In Avanti, there was ruled by two rulers, named Binda and Anubinda. And there is a Athenian democracy. When we say Spartan democracy, we compare Athens was more inclined to intellectualism and Sparta was more inclined to the bodybuilding and the physical part of the thing and the citizenship. Citizenry was more important. The person born first as citizen, then an individual. Same thing it was in Athenian democracy. And there was a kingless democracy in Malwa. And I'm giving two examples. How our kings were the constitutional slave. Rudra Daman wanted to repair one Sudarshan Lake. The minister said, you cannot repair by the government treasury. This is not the decision of the state. So you can do by your own purse. And Rudra Daman was compelled to spend his own money rather than state's treasury. We all know the story of Ashoka when he was sending money to Kurukuta Rama. He was stopped by the prince. And he was supported by the prince was supported by the minister. Then Ashoka called the prince and asked, who is sovereign? The minister said, you are sovereign. He said, I am a sovereign of the half apple. This is the constitutional democracy, and that constitutional democracy existed in India. What I am mentioning is the figment of that democratic process which existed in India. There's a famous quote, I think, as we quote in political science book, Magna Carta. What is Magna Carta? Something in that glorious revolution took place on the Magna Carta of the Queen and King. But we fail to quote our own Buddha's message. If I compare with that, I can say it is Magna Carta plus. There's a story that when Magadha empires wanted to attack this Vaishali or Lakshmi, the emperor sent his messenger to Buddha to get advice whether he should attack or not. Then responding directly to him, Buddha said to his disciple Anand, "Have you heard, Anand, that visions often hold full and frequent assemblies?" Ananda replied, "Affirmative." Buddha then further said that, "So long visions hold full and frequent assembly, so long they meet together in concord, so long they enact nothing which already existed, which not already exists established, or abrogate nothing that has already been enacted, so long they honor and esteem and support the Viji elders, so long no woman, girls belong to them are abducted or detained, so long they honor, support Vijayan's sacred monuments. So long as the rightful protection, defense exists, Vijayan's would not decline, they would prosper." The message was sent. So how a republic should work, how the republic should govern, which the same thing was the Raj Dharma in Santi Parvin Mahabharata. So we failed to internalize, deliberate, project, and understand our own constitutional system. And that's why he wrote K.P. Jaiswal says that whatever he wrote is a very small thing. Many things have to be done. But even after 7 decades of his death, the Indian social science failed to do something substantive. That failure constitutes 3 reverse doctrine for us. I call reverse doctrine. 1, that we are divided and we are bracketed or bracketing each other on very trivial issues which are not going to be borrowed by the posterity or future generation. Because whatever we are doing discourse, today's discourse has not impacted even 24 hours later. What to say about the 10 years or 20 or 50 years, number one. Second important thing, that mass education and the research-based education, there should be a difference between the two. There should be freedom, there should be protection, there should be patronage, but that protection and patronage should based not on dictating and directing. The students and research should feel free. Since independence, we found that the battle of hegemony of idea. When there is a battle of hegemony of idea, then the academic community turns into communities, just like Hindu caste system, that one caste is fighting against other, one caste is claiming superiority over others. So this sense of this very petty things should be avoided by all of us. And lastly, I will mention that where did we fail? That one important thing that you know, the when we call the subaltern study, and that subaltern study is a new innovation in the field of academics. When I say that, have we done a study of our past thinkers? Who was Kabir? Who was Ray Das? Was he not, if I use the term subaltern, Ray Das, Kabir, or Ramda, who were they? They were subalterns. They were talking about the common people. They were encountering the experiences of the common people, their tradition, they were trying to reform, they're trying to preach them. Other thing that I will end with one thing that happened in our past and also in the contemporary era. That, you know, that during the British period, when we talk about the India's independence, we talk in terms of one imperialism, but there are multiple imperialism in the country. Professor Pransby can focus on these, the Goa liberation movement. I'm giving one instance that how we are willful subordinates. That is the reason that our academic, our intelligentsia, our intellectual tradition, we all became subordinate to the so-called superior power of the West. The Mohan Lakshman Ranade was arrested in 1955 in Goa. And he remained 14 years jail. What is important when he was arrested? In 1965, his mother was losing her eyesight. So the Red Cross Society's president came to India. And he said, he advised her mother, his mother, to give a mercy petition. And this was rejected by Portuguese. He was deported to Lisbon. He was so popular freedom fighter that even UAE, Mexico government intervened, but that failed. But what is important, in 1966, Atal Bihari Vajpayee raised the question in the Rajya Sabha. In the Rajya Sabha, he asked that what efforts were being made, but what he mentioned is more important that India released 3,500 Portuguese prisoners. And while releasing the Portuguese prisoners, India had not mentioned about Mohan Lakshman Ranade. Unconditional release. And Ranade, ultimately, her mother could not meet. He was in 1969, 4 years after the Goa was liberated. So this kind of political leadership which we had, we are a cosmopolitan in their sense. But when the cosmopolitan, in Hindi we call Diya ke niche Andhira. They were cosmopolitan. They were talking about apartheid. They were talking about the Athens. You will find the quote from Athens. They were talking about the Brussels conference. They were talking about the non-alignment, but they were not talking about their own democracy. They were not talking about their own tradition. So these are very important things which we need to work, and we need to work not for ours. We are the heirs of the past and the present and possessors of the future. In that context, we must work despite all the odds. And I will just mention one story of Swet Ketu. Swet Ketu got education in an ashram of Rishi. At the age of 24, he came back after 12 years of education. He said to his father that, "I am well versed in Vedas." His father offered him to get married. He himself was a Rishi. Swet Ketu said no. "Main jab Janak ka Raj Sabha jeet kar aa jaunga, tab main shaadi hoga." The moment he responded, his father realized that he had knowledge of words. He has knowledge of verses, but he lacks the true knowledge. Then he examined his teacher, examined his son, and that is a very important thing that he asked, what is truth? He failed to answer. And there is a story that he asked me, ki uch namak ko pani mein mila do. Phir usko test karne kaha, to bola namkeen lagta hai. Kaha pani ko phek do, jameen pe test kiya to bhi namkeen laga. Kaha namak ko alag karo, nahi kar paya. To kaha it is internalization of truth. The truth should be internalized like that. उसने उन्होंने कहा एक बरगद का फल ले आओ उसको तोड़ा कहा इसके नीचे क्या कहा बीज है इस बीज को तोड़ो उसके नीचे क्या कहा मालूम नहीं कहा इस माइक्रो चीज से एक बड़ा पेड़ होता है और उस पेड़ से फल होता है तो जो तुम में है वो मुझ में है जो नगुबी वहाँ अफ्रीका में कहते हैं उबंतु जो हम कहते हैं वो दोनों में एक कई कई दार्शनिक समानता है और इसी दार्शनिक समानता में द क्वेश्चन ऑफ बाइनरी विच इज ए वेस्टर्न एक्सक्लूसिवली वेस्टर्न प्रोडक्ट यू एंड मी द अदरनेस दैट लैक्स इन आवर डिस्कोर्स but we have imposed ourselves with that discourse. We enjoy that discourse, us and them. So this kind of willful narcissism, we should free ourselves from the willful narcissism that I am dominating you, I am defeating you, you dominated us. So revengeful narcissism or willful narcissism, both are bad. So I consider that this institute is doing a very wonderful job. And this seminar is not a seminar just like any other academic seminar. Professor Pranjpe has initiated, and I see the enthusiasm of Professor Rajvi Sharma ji. This seminar is going to yield something very concrete, and I think that in future there would be free, fair, and objective study on the question of decolonization, which will take consideration of the freedom movement. Decolonization of the British period, also pre-British period, and I think that would be a very, very concrete contribution to Indian system of knowledge and recreating, reconstructing, which Professor Jaiswal had offered and also hoped for the future. Professor, these words, I again thank to Professor Pranjpe for inviting me for the keynote address. Very, very thank you. Namaskar.
थैंक यू सो मच डॉक्टर सिन्हा. जब आप बात कर रहे थे मुझे वो चीज़ याद आ गई कि आपने एक प्राइवेट मेंबर बिल पार्लियामेंट में छेड़ दिया कि सोशलिस्ट ये शब्द जो है संविधान में उसको निकाला जाए. तो इससे मैं ये कहना चाह रहा हूँ कि यू आर एन ओरिजिनल माइंड एंड यू आर ऑल्सो फियरलेस. और मुझे ये भी याद आ गया, आई टोल्ड द अदर्स बिफोर यू जॉइंड, सॉरी
एक हस्तक्षेप करूं मैं. इसके लोगों ने रीजन ये ट्रेस किया कि आई एम अगेंस्ट द वर्ड सोशलिज्म.
नॉट एट ऑल
आई एम नॉट प्रो अगेंस्ट, बट आई फाउंड दैट इंडिया सिंस 1991 इज लिबरलाइजिंग एवरीथिंग, डूइंग एवरीथिंग व्हाट सोशलिज्म मींस. Then this word is not only useless, but it is being abused. So this word should be obliterated from the preamble of the constitution. That is one of the reasons which, had it been accepted, I would have given the reasons that all the logics of socialism is missing, and all the logics of neoliberalism is flourishing, whether whatever the regime may be. So I am against the neoliberalism. I consider neoliberalism is more dangerous than even the communism and capitalism. Thank you.
Exactly. What I was simply trying to say is that you were against the hypocrisy that having that word in the preamble reduces us to. We are reduced to a nation of hypocrites. And the story from the Upanishad, Chandogya Upanishad, Aruni Uddalaka and Shweta Ketu is about that. It's ultimately about hypocrisy versus truth. And you cannot decolonize if you're so hypocritical. The transfer of power was, as you rightly said, only partial, and much more needs to be done. And the reason is that we were not truly decolonized. The British handed over power to their own minions, their own chosen representatives who carried on those same traditions. And therefore, the real work of decolonization is yet to be done. This is what I was trying to say. And I remember I mentioned also before you joined that you've written a booklet called Swaraj in Ideas, published by your Indian Policy Foundation. My request to you is if you add what you said today, we will make both of them together, wo 100 page ki kitab ho jayegi, wo 45 pages ki hai, mere paas hai wo. Today, what you said is an extension of those ideas. You've brought in Nalanda, you've brought in the story of the great freedom fighter Ranade from Goa, you know, all these stories can come into this. Jaiswal sahab ki baat aayi hai. There are many important things you've touched on. So I think it's logical if you find a little bit of time to give the part two of that booklet, and we will publish it from IIS as a book. A comprehensive book aa jayegi. I think it'll be a great idea. Now, actually, see, I will invite Rajvi ji to say a few words, but we are coming almost to the end of this session, which finishes at 4 o'clock. But my real question is, normally keynotes do not have Q&A, but it's to Dr. Sinha, it's up to him, because Chaturvedi ji, Dr. Sachin Chaturvedi ji had to go to another meeting, he has left already. So if you want a couple of questions, then I will permit. If you are busy,
we can take it up. Sure, sir.
All right, very good. So please type your question in the chat box and send it to me. And in the meanwhile, I'll invite Professor Rajveer Sharma to offer some comments on Rakesh Sinha's presentation. I might add that they have known each other for many years, and it would just be in the appropriateness of things that he also comments on Dr. Sinha's address. Go ahead, sir. Sir, unmute kar dijiyega.
I was saying that thank you very much, Honorable Director Professor Pranjpe, for giving me an opportunity to make certain observations on what Professor Rakesh Sinha has said. In fact, I have been a very keen listener to Professor Rakesh Sinha on various occasions. And he has always been, in fact, trying to place things in a perspective which in itself is indicative of Swaraj in ideas. In fact, three, four things which Professor Sinha has indicated is that even after independence, we continue to be enslaved by the ideological moorings of Europe, and also we have not been able to put across what Indian knowledge tradition has been, in fact, arguing for. And I completely agree with Professor Sinha that Indian knowledge tradition, without being a victim of presentism, as he said right in the beginning, that he is not in favor of presentism, but at the same time, we must not hesitate. We must not escape from what we have to offer for the world. This is what Professor Sachin Chaturvedi was also saying, that there are certain indigenous ideas which are meant for the welfare of the whole humanity. And at the same time, Professor Sinha is also arguing that let us not engage in some kind of a fruitless discussion, but at the same time, we must not ignore the vast treasure house which India has. And there's a need for exploration of Indian knowledge system. There's a need for revalidation of the Indian knowledge system. And we must reinvent as to what in fact is relevant to the modern society, so-called modern within quotes. Whether it is really modern or not, I have my own doubts. But at the same time, Professor Sinha, in fact, has been the ardent supporter of two things. Ek to wo ye kehte hain ki dekho bhai, dogmatism will lead to no place, nowhere. And therefore, dogmatism of any kind must be avoided. Ye Dr. Rakesh Sinha lagatar apni baaton mein bhi aur apni writings mein bhi point out karte rahe hain. Ek to ye. और दूसरा जो प्रोफेसर राकेश सिन्हा अपनी बातों से भी और राइटिंग्स में भी कहते रहे हैं कि डीकॉलोनाइजेशन कैन नॉट कम ओनली थ्रू सम काइंड ऑफ अ टॉक, वी विल हैव टू परसू इट सिंसियरली इन अवर राइटिंग्स एंड आल्सो इन द डिस्कोर्सेस अक्रॉस द कंट्री एंड आल्सो अक्रॉस द वर्ल्ड. मुझे लगता है कि मुझे ज़्यादा कहने की आवश्यकता नहीं है. आज जिस प्रकार से उन्होंने यू नो ए वेरी ब्रिलियंट एनलाइटनिंग टॉक दी है, हम सिन्हा साहब आपके बहुत आभारी हैं कि आपने हमारा निमंत्रण भी स्वीकार किया और ये कितना अच्छा भाषण हम सब लोगों के सामने रखा। और मैं प्रोफेसर प्रांजपे जी की इस बात से सहमत हूँ कि अगर आप अपने पहले पार्ट वन को पार्ट टू से जोड़ दें तो ये IIS भी उसको पब्लिश करेगा। और मुझे लगता है कि वो जो हमारे दूसरे लोग इस एंटरप्राइज में लगे हैं उनको भी इससे फायदा होगा। थैंक यू सो मच।
यू नो आई जस्ट वांटेड टू ऐड अ फुटनोट, वो ये कि एसेंशियली आई डोंट नो इफ मेनी पीपल नो दिस बट दिस क्वेश्चन ऑफ डीकोलोनाइजेशन वाज रेज्ड बाय डॉक्टर सिन्हा इन द पार्लियामेंट आल्सो। एज फार एज आई नो ही इज द ओनली वन, ही स्पोक maybe he had only 2-3 minutes, but I heard that intervention on YouTube or on that Lok Sabha channel. It was a very powerful, thoughtful intervention, well thought out, and like a true scholar. So I want to just say one or two things. You know, the point is many people look at it as an East versus West story. I don't see it like that. The intellectual history of the world is incomplete without a proper description of the Indian contribution, whether it is to ideas of democracy, pluralism, Magna Carta, as he explained. We are not fighting anybody. We are just saying that, listen, we need a more comprehensive account of what happened to these institutions, these ideas. So the theory of social contract, I think Professor Sharma is also working on this vis-a-vis Kautilya. So we are only saying that our knowledge of human society and its evolution is incomplete because the Indian contribution has not been properly, forget about being included, but properly understood. And let us not wait for others to do it. Hum to, as he said, we are glorified plagiarists. Wo jo karte hain, hum hi karte hain. And he's absolutely right. See, all these discourses are controlled by the West. Plus, post-colonialism pe maine char kitabe likhi hai. I've tried to show that see, Indians stationed in the West, subalternism, Ranjit Goyal, Indians stationed in the West are working for a kind of neo-imperialistic, discursive control of narratives. And they are serving their Western masters. That is obvious. And we in India are unable to counter that. This is the fact. Many of our best minds are located in these institutions abroad. So the decolonization of Indian universities, syllabi, all this is very, very important because otherwise, I won't take names. These people, whoever they are, he mentioned Gayatri, Chakravarti, Spivak, I can mention 25 names. They are located in privileged institutions abroad. Abhi CAA ki baat lijiye, take 370, take Twitter pe jo chal raha hai, digital recolonization of India, on which Tarun Vijayji will speak. See, there are people located in these institutions abroad. I have a friend in Singapore and he criticizes India. I want to tell him, try and criticize Singapore, they'll kick you out. They won't tolerate you. Aap wahan baithte hain, you get a fantastic salary there and your whole job is to criticize India. There's another person who sits in Sweden. Wohi din raat karte rehte hain. So, they have made this, they have arranged all these people. Rajiv Malhotra ji calls them sepoys. And he's right. You see, when I went to Hong Kong, they told me, you know, we don't like Indians. And I said, why? Because he said, the British used Indian sepoys to police us. Sikhs and Pathans were used to maintain law and order. So you see, we are very happy to work for other masters. You will see in East Asia, Japan, nobody works, you know, Japan didn't get colonized quite in that way. But Korea, when Koreans were colonized, very few Koreans worked for the Japanese. When China was colonized by Japan, very few Chinese worked for the Japanese colonizers. In India, we all worked for British East India Company. Company Bahadur ki sangya unko de di. So these are very deep things to think about. And I can only say one word, which is, you know, if I look at the history of India, and people will criticize me for saying this, but as Sinha Saab said, contestation to hona chahiye, hai na? Agar IIS mein contestation nahi hoga, to kahan hoga? To dekhiye, jo kshatriya तत्व था उसको जो मुस्लिम रूल इन इंडिया था उसमें द क्षत्रिय तत्व वाज उसको डिस्ट्रॉय किया गया इन डिफरेंट वेज. एक तो देयर वर बैटल्स इन व्हिच देयर वर वाइप्ड आउट डिफीटेड इनकॉर्पोरेटेड थ्रू मैरिजेस इनकॉर्पोरेशन कन्वर्जन. यू हैव होल कम्युनिटीज ऑफ राजपूत्स इंक्लूडिंग आवर फ्रेंड तारिक फतेह. यू लुक एट हिज लिनिएज, ही वाज अ राजपूत. So please understand what was happening. So that element, the Kshatriya hood, 800 years of a certain kind of rule. That's why I said notions of Swaraj have to be extended back to the medieval times. And the so-called Brahmin, that is the intellectual thing, that was destroyed during the British time. See, that was a very well concerted effort. The intellectual class was destroyed and co-opted. So to rebuild Indian civilization, you have to rebuild these activities, not on the basis of a military system, but on the basis of training and competence. Luckily, I must say, the Vaishyas of India, my goodness, they were so energetic. They were so resourceful. From Burma, Hong Kong, Thailand, har jagah pahunch gaye. Ek Marwadi hota tha, lota leke kahin pahunch jata tha. If you see how wealth was preserved, banking system, इस पे पूरी स्टडी होनी चाहिए. एंड ऑफ कोर्स द सो कॉल्ड सर्विस क्लास, माय गुडनेस व्हाट दे डिड. दे बिल्ड रेलवेज इन अफ्रीका, दे वर्क्ड ऑन शुगर प्लांटेशंस फ्रॉम फिजी टू सूरीनाम. ये सब हिस्ट्रीज अभी हमने हमको लिखनी है. द हिस्ट्री ऑफ व्हाट इंडियंस डिड टू द वर्ल्ड, हाउ मेनी इंडियंस फॉट इन द फर्स्ट वर्ल्ड वॉर. एनी हाउ आई एम गेटिंग बिट impassioned, so I will control myself and invite our former Tagore fellow, Professor C.K. Raju, and he's a great thinker. He's a part of our conference. He was a fellow 20-25 years ago when I first came to IIAS as well. And if he says anything controversial, nobody should be surprised. Go ahead, Professor Raju.
Thank you. राकेश सिन्हा जी, आपसे एक सवाल था. आपने जो कहा कि डीकोलोनाइजेशन में इंडिया और अफ्रीका में फर्क है, अब मैं हिंदुस्तान में भी और अफ्रीका में भी डीकोलोनाइजेशन पे काम कर रहा हूँ. ये मेरी किताब है, इस पे अभी मैंने एक लंबा चौड़ा 5 घंटे का भाषण दिया है जो कि यूट्यूब पे अवेलेबल है. रज्जु गणित, और अफ्रीका में स्ट्रिंग ज्योमेट्री होती थी. और मेरा ये कहना है कि जब तक हम मैथमेटिक्स को डीकोलोनाइज नहीं करेंगे, क्योंकि आप देखें मैकॉले ने क्या कहा, उसने कहा आपके पास है पोएट्री, है मिल्टन के समान नहीं है लेकिन है पोएट्री, लेकिन हार्ड साइंसेस में वी आर यू नो कंप्लीटली वी आर इमेजरेबली सुपीरियर. तो आप जब तक मैथमेटिक्स और साइंस को नहीं बदल सकते, आप कुछ नहीं कर सकते. आप देखिए, ये किताब तो लिखी है, अब इससे एनसीईआरटी से झगड़ा चल रहा है, 15-20 साल से झगड़ा चल रहा है. आप कुछ नहीं करने वाले हैं, बात करने वाले हैं, गोष्ठी करने वाले हैं, काम कुछ नहीं करने वाले हैं. ये है आपके सामने, पूरा मटेरियल है, दूसरे देशों में होगा, यहां नहीं होगा, ये खाली बात चलेगी. इतना कहना चाहिए.
प्रोफेसर राजू, थैंक यू. आई वंस अगेन इनवाइट यू टू होस्ट अ टेक्स्ट बुक, अ राइटिंग प्रोजेक्ट ऑन गणित एंड मैथ. IIAS is happy to host it. We are already initiating a history historiography pe hum ek July mein sanghoshthi kar rahe hain. Usme videsh se aur Bharat se jo hamare itihaskar hain wo judenge. Main aapse dobara request kar raha hu, maine aapke sath is pe koshish kari. Many people are either afraid of you aur pata nahi kya hai. Maine itne logon se baat ki, इवन भार्गव जी से हमने पूछा और आपके साथ ज्वाइन ही नहीं करना चाहते. मंजुल भार्गव जी वाज पार्ट ऑफ आवर एनईपी राइटिंग. तो ये कोई विडंबना है, आप एकमेव अद्वितीय है जो इसमें योद्धा जो कहते हैं, गणित के योद्धा. हम आपको गणित योद्धा का एक खास पुरस्कार भी देने को तैयार है, बताइए. लेकिन मैं आपको दोबारा से कहता हूँ, आपका स्वास्थ्य अगर ठीक हो, हम आपको दोबारा यहाँ बुलाएंगे. एक आपको गणित पे और मैथमेटिक्स पे ये जो टेक्स्ट बुक का वर्कशॉप करना जरूरी है. एंड आई मस्ट से Decolonizing science is very important. We are having a session on this with a famous IIT professor, Sripad Kalmalkarji. He'll be here. He's probably here now. And you are also part of that session. MD Srinivasji will be there. We are committed to this. And Dharampalji has written about this also. So, dheere dheere cheeze hoti hai. I'm not answering on behalf of Rakesh Sinhaji. He will give you a better answer. But I'll tell you the answer I am given. I am a deeply frustrated man. मैं आपको साफ साफ बता रहा हूँ इंस्टीट्यूट में इतनी जो जिस दौर से हम गुजरे हैं बहुत सारे लोग वाकिफ हैं एंड यू नो वॉट पीपल टेल मी व्हेन आई गो एंड टॉक टू देम ही सेड देखो मकरंद यहाँ से परिदृश्य कुछ और है आप जहाँ बैठते हैं वहाँ कुछ और है यानी जो पोलिटिकल क्लास है दे हैव अ डिफरेंट सेट ऑफ चैलेंजेस Intellectual class has a different set of challenges. So my humble submission is do not wait for any support from the political class. We must do what we have to. And I want to tell you, this is what main 60 varsh paar kar chuka hun. I do not want support from anybody for anything. Jo mera swadharma hai, wo to main karunga. Agar dusron ki madad, vinamrata se madad mangenge, main mana nahi kar raha hun. मैंने इंस्टीट्यूट के लिए कितने दरवाजे खटखटाए मैं तो इंस्टीट्यूट के लिए कुछ भी करने को तैयार हूँ मगर मुझे अपेक्षाएं बहुत कम है पॉलिटिकल क्लास की अपनी मजबूरियां होती हैं यू नो एंड लेट अस डू हमारे हमारे हाथ में जितना है और इतना सारा है मैं एक छोटी सी चीज कहना चाहता हूँ बिकॉज वी आर बींग ओपन यू नो वी ऑल हैव अ म्यूचुअल फ्रेंड क्लॉड अल्वारेस So, एक बार मैं गोवा में मुझे बुलाया गया He has worked on science, on decolonizing science. So, Goa University called me for a refresher course. And they said, sir, give us some names of people we can call. Because it was on post-colonialism. I said, you have somebody right here in your backyard. Claude Alvarez, he's done an amazing PhD looking at the history of science and etc. He said, sir, we can't call him. So, I said, क्या हुआ? सर एक बार हमने उनको बुलाने की भूल की और यू नो व्हाट ही सेड यू गाइस ही यूज सम अनपार्लियामेंट्री लैंग्वेज यू हैव जस्ट सेल्फ रिस्पेक्ट एंड अ कूली दिस इज व्हाट ही टोल्ड द पार्टिसिपेंट्स ऑफ द रिफ्रेशर कोर्स हु आर टीचर्स ही सेड यू नो इफ अ कूली को आप 100 रुपए से कम दोगे वो तो सामान पटक देगा सेइंग यू नो यू कैरी योर ओन लगेज बट आप लोग जो एकेडेमिक्स हैं यू हैव नो करेज यू हैव नो गट्स You never stand up, you know, for what you believe. Before you're asked to bend, you will bow. So anyhow, so Claude Alvarez was never again invited. So I'm only saying that the colonization, decolonization starts with us academics. We are secure in our jobs. Usually we can't be kicked out. And yet we are so gutless, you know, unfortunately. So, you know, the Indian... Original academic used to be Rishi Muni to bahut badi cheeze hain even Chanakya they never cared for power they said what they wanted to say let's start with ourselves I'm inviting you meri jitni simit mere paas jo suvidhaen hain main publicly aapko invite kar raha hu I agree ganit has to be brought out mathematics must be decolonized I must tell you I admire professor Raju he has given an award not given announced Anybody can prove the historical existence of Euclid will get 2 lakh rupees. He himself will pay. Nobody has been able to prove Euclid. Why do we worry if we can prove whether Kautilya existed, Bharata existed, what Kalidasa's dates were? When Euclid is taught in every textbook in the world, one day Kautilya will be taught in every textbook in the world. Thank you.
आपने बहुत महत्वपूर्ण मुद्दा उठाया यदि आप कुछ काम कर रहे हैं और एकेडमिक फ्रीडम के अंतर्गत कर रहे हैं और आपका कोई मौलिक रिसर्च है और उसको इग्नोर किया जा रहा है तो हम इस जो करना चाहिए मैं सिर्फ चाहिए कर रहा हूँ करना चाहिए मैं करूँगा और आप एक बहुत मौलिक काम कर रहे हैं भारत और अफ्रीका के बीच के डिकोलाइजेशन के ऊपर काम कर रहे हैं, साइंस और मैथमेटिक्स को डिकोलाइज की बात कर रहे हैं, एक नया डायमेंशन है मेरे माइंड में, तो ये डायमेंशन तक नहीं कि मैथमेटिक्स और साइंस को भी डिकोलाइज किया जा सकता, मुझे लगा नेचुरल साइंस शायद बहुत कम उसमें डिकोलाइजेशन की स्पेस है, लेकिन आप कर रहे हैं तो आप मुझे बताएंगे, मैं आपसे मिलूंगा और जो मेरे सामर्थ्य में है, जो मेरी जिसको कहते हैं जो मेरी मॉरल कैपेसिटी है, नॉट पॉलिटिकल कैपेसिटी, उस मॉरल कैपेसिटी का मैं यूज करूंगा। एक बात मैं आपको कहना चाहता हूं, देखिए कोई सभ्यता और देश सरकार के पैट्रोनेज से नहीं बना है। आप क्लासिफाई कर लीजिए जिन लोगों ने पैट्रोनेज से बुक लिखा है या जिन लोगों ने पैट्रोनेज को रिवर्स करने के लिए, उनको उनकी ओबीडियंस को पे करने के लिए ग्रेटिट्यूड में बुक्स लिखा है, जिन लोगों ने एडवर्स कंडीशन में बुक लिखा है, ऑडिटरी जिसको कहते हैं, दोनों का अंतर देखिए। गैलीलियो को क्यों मारा गया? देर कैन नॉट बी सच एडवर्स कंडीशन कि वो नी ऑन हिज नी हैंड ऑन बाइबिल ही वाज कंपेल्ड टू एब्जर्व हिज ओन डॉक्ट्रिन दैट अर्थ मूव्स बिकॉज ऑन द थ्रेट ऑफ डेथ। और ब्रूनो को क्यों मारा गया? बिकॉज उन्होंने कॉस्मिक पोलरिज्म की बात की, बट ही वॉज स्किल्ड, ही सेड के यू आर अफ्रेड फ्रॉम माई माइंड। लेकिन इंडिया में क्या है, पीपल डोंट अफ्रेड फ्रॉम माइंड। इंडिया हैज अ सिंगल एग्जाम्पल ऑफ प्रोसिक्यूशन ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ इंटेलेक्चुअलिज्म, दैट वॉज दारा सिको। ही वॉज नॉट प्रोसिक्यूटेड, ही वॉज चैलेंज टू द औरंगजेब, एम्पायर ऑफ औरंगजेब, बिकॉज दैट टाइम ही केम आउट फ्रॉम दैट रेस। ही ट्रांसलेटेड 52 उपनिषद्स और कविंद्र सरस्वती फ्रॉम वाराणसी एंड दारा सिको, हार्डली पीपल ऑल क्रेडिट टू दारा सिको, बट कविंद्र सरस्वती प्लेड अ वेरी वाइटल रोल इन ट्रांसलेशन एंड बोथ डिड द वर्क एंड दारा सिको वाज प्रोसिक्यूटेड, दैट इज सिंगल एग्जांपल। बट चैतन्य चैलेंज, शंकराचार्य चैलेंज, एवरीबॉडी फर्स्ट चैलेंज देन गिव देयर थ्योरी, नोबडी प्रोसिक्यूटेड। Had Chaitanya, had there would be the contestation not been accepted in Indian ethos, then Chaitanya would have been punished. Shankaracharya and the Buddha would not have survived when he was challenging the Vedic rituals and everything. So, despite all these things, जो एक बात मैं आपने उठाया तो मैं कहा कि ये सब करना क्यों छूट गया? Despite the destruction of Nalanda University, Takshila University, millions of manuscripts have been stolen and destroyed. India has still जो हुई चीज इज चैलेंज फॉर द इंस्टीट्यूशन लाइक प्राण, बिकॉज डॉक्टर प्राणपे हिमसेल्फ इज एन जेन्युइन एकेडमिशियन, आई थिंक जेन्युइन एकेडमिशियन, दैट्स व्हाई ही स्पीक्स वेरी फ्रीली एंड फोर्थराइटली दैट वी हैव 5 million मैन्युस्क्रिप्ट इन इंडिया, ओनली द संपूर्णानंद संस्कृत यूनिवर्सिटी हैज 1,40,000, राजस्थान ओरिएंटल रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूट हैज 1,16,000, इन चेन्नई द मैन्युस्क्रिप्ट लाइब्रेरी हैज 72,000, भंडारकर इंस्टीट्यूट 21,000 मैन्युस्क्रिप्ट, दे आर ऑल, नो रिसर्चर्स गोइंग टू डू दैट। डस्ट डस्ट और मैन्युस्क्रिप्ट, इसका ही संबंध है, मैन्युस्क्रिप्ट को बचाने में लगे हुए हैं। तो अभी बहुत काम, जैसे आप मैथमेटिक्स में काम करें, बहुत एरिया है जिसमें काम करना है। बताइए जिस देश में 5 million ट्रेस्ड मैन्युस्क्रिप्ट है, अनट्रेस्ड मैन्युस्क्रिप्ट कितना, मुझे लगता है इससे कम अनट्रेस्ड मैन्युस्क्रिप्ट इंडिया में नहीं होगा। हमारा 60,000 मैन्युस्क्रिप्ट यूरोप में पड़ा हुआ है, 1,50,000 मैन्युस्क्रिप्ट एशियन एंड साउथ एशियन कंट्रीज में इंडियन मैन्युस्क्रिप्ट पड़ा हुआ है। तो अभी बहुत काम करना है, और प्राणपे साहब तो रिसर्च करते हैं, इसलिए मैं कह रहा हूँ जो इंडिया में नॉन, आप जब आर्काइव जाएंगे, जब मैं आर्काइव में रिसर्च करता था 10 साल तक, मैं सुबह से शाम तक बैठा रहता था, तो जब भी कोई फाइल डिमांड करूँ तो एंटी, मैं कहा ये एंटी क्या, नॉन ड्राफ्ट फाइल, तो वो फाइल वहाँ के रख दिए। आखिर वो अभी अमेरिका में एक ऐसा लाइब्रेरी क्रिएट किया जा रहा है पिछले 20 ईयर्स से, जिसमें हम सबको यूज किया जा रहा है, जिसमें आपको सारे वर्ल्ड के डॉक्यूमेंट, अगर आरएसएस का या इंडिया का जो स्मॉलेस्ट पार्टी है सोशलिस्ट सिविल सेंटर ऑफ इंडिया बंगाल का, वहां से लेकर द बिगेस्ट बीजेपी ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, उसका जो छोटा डॉक्यूमेंट है वो वहां के लाइब्रेरी में मिल जाएगा। 1872 का जो फर्स्ट सेंसस इंडिया का हुआ, वो आप इंडिया के लाइब्रेरी में ढूंढ जाइए, जो पॉपुलेशन का सेंटर वहां भी ढूंढ जाइए, आपको नहीं मिलेगा, कोई मिसिंग डॉक्यूमेंट मिलेगा, लेकिन वो सारा डॉक्यूमेंट आपको सेंसस का डॉक्यूमेंट अमेरिका की लाइब्रेरी में मिल जाएगा। सो दे अंडरस्टैंड द इंपॉर्टेंस ऑफ आइडिया, दे अंडरस्टैंड द इंपॉर्टेंस ऑफ इंटेलेक्चुअल, दे कुड अंडरस्टैंड कि रोमन सिविलाइजेशन क्यों डिक्लाइन किया,
The moment they started giving importance to metaphysics and ignoring the intellectuals, that Roman civilization declined in decades. Built in the centuries and declined in decades. कोई भी मोमेंट, कोई भी इंडिविजुअल, यू अंडरस्टैंड, जब मेरे पास स्टडी रूम नहीं था और जब मेरे पास कंप्यूटर नहीं था तो मैं बहुत काम करता था. जब मैं इंट्रोस्पेक्ट किया, जब मैंने स्टडी रूम बना लिया, एक की जगह दो कंप्यूटर ले लिया, एक की जगह दो मोबाइल ले लिया, तो मेरा स्टडी रूम संभालने में ही समय चला जाता. तो आई अल्टीमेटली डिसाइडेड कि मैं ये स्टडी रूम को छोड़ो, ये कंप्यूटर छोड़ो, जहां से बैठ कर लिखो. जो पाम लीफ पे जो लिखते थे उनके पास क्या काम. तो देखिए, सिविलाइजेशन बनाने के लिए हम निकले. आज का सेमिनार का मैं इंपॉर्टेंस ये समझता हूँ और मैं डॉक्टर प्रांजपे को इससे धन्यवाद देता हूँ कि देर आर मेनी इशूज. इन्होंने एक आत्मनिर्भर भारत विचारों का आत्मनिर्भरता की बात कही. वो आत्मनिर्भरता कोई बहुत लाइट सेंस में नहीं है. ये हमको पेन, जब तक हमको दर्द नहीं होगा ना, जब आप दर्द महसूस करेंगे, जैसे मैं एक पॉलिटिशियन को कहा कि यदि सोते समय आपको कोई 15,000 रुपये अर्न करने वाले पिता की पुत्री फटा हुआ कपड़ा पहने हुए है, जब वो याद आएगी और आपकी आंखों में आंसू आएगा, दैट डे यू विल बिकम द इंडियन पॉलिटिशियन, अदरवाइज यू विल रिमेन एज ए प्रोफेशनल पॉलिटिशियन. कि आपको ही अपना, तो ये है, ये बहुत डायमेंशंस हैं. वी हैव टू डेवलप आवर मॉरल कैपेसिटी. हमारा मॉरल, देखिए, फिजिकल कैपेसिटी और इंटेलेक्चुअल कैपेसिटी को हम कवर कर सकते यदि मॉरल कैपेसिटी डेवलप करेंगे. और इसीलिए एसेंस ऑफ नॉलेज जो एसो विजय ने लिखा था, उसे 32 क्वालिटीज दिया था, इंटेलेक्चुअल एंड मॉरल क्वालिटीज. विदाउट दी 32 क्वालिटीज नोबडी विल बी इंटेलेक्चुअल्स. इन वेस्ट वी डोंट रिक्वायर्ड क्वालिटीज. यदि आप इमोरल हैं, आप किताब अच्छी लिख रहे हैं, तो यू आर इंटेलेक्चुअल. इंडिया में पात्रता देखी जाती है, पात्रता. दैट एसो विजय हैज मेंशन 32 क्वालिटी, इंटेलेक्चुअल एंड मॉरल क्वालिटीज ऑफ इंटेलेक्चुअल. सो वी विल गो अहेड. और इसमें ऑड भी आएगा, आपको ऑब्स्ट्रक्शन भी आएगा, आप इग्नोर भी किया जाएगा. लेकिन जब दारा सिको और ब्रूनो और गैलीलियो को नहीं रोक पाए, 1632 में गैलीलियो को फांसी दी गई, 17 फरवरी 1600 को 1600 को ब्रूनो को जला दिया गया, और गैलीलियो को वो फ्यूनरल के बाद उसको जो ग्राउंड होता है वो ग्राउंड नहीं प्रोवाइड किया गया ये ब्रूनो को. तो ये सब चीज़ें हैं. हमें इंटेलेक्चुअल को सेल्फ, मैं इंटेलेक्चुअल्स के बारे में दो कहता हूँ, सेल्फ एग्जाइल्ड जो कर सकता है, अपने आप को सेल्फ एग्जाइल्ड करने का मतलब है फिजिकल वर्ल्ड से कट जाते, पैट्रोनेस से कट जाते. दुनिया में अखबार में सुबह क्या छप रहा है, टेलीविजन में कौन सा कौन किसको गाली दे रहा है, उससे आप कट जाते हैं. सिनेमा क्या चल रहा है, कट जाते हैं. वो आप सोसाइटी को प्रयोगशाला बनाते हैं, एक सेल्फ एग्जाइट होना. दूसरा, पैशन कैसे, इंस्ट्रूमेंटल वर्क क्या होता है, जैसे हमें किसी ने दे दिया 5 चैप्टर लिखने, इंस्ट्रूमेंटल वर्क होता है जो हम अपने को सेल्फ असाइंड करते हैं. ये दो चीज़ यदि इंटेलेक्चुअलिज्म आ गया, जो कल्हण के पास था, जो अभिनव गुप्त के पास था, जो शंकराचार्य के पास था, जिस उम्र में हम पीएचडी करते हैं उस उम्र में शंकराचार्य जी तो जा चुके थे, जिस उम्र में हम जॉब ढूंढते हैं उस उम्र में स्वामी विवेकानंद जा चुके थे. तो जिस लैंड में इतने इतनी इंस्पायरिंग लिविंग ऑटोबायोग्राफीज हो, बायोग्राफीज हो, उसमें हमें कभी निराशा के भाव से नहीं जाती, आपको निराशा के भाव से निकल जाएगी.
बहुत बढ़िया, बहुत ही अच्छा आपने, और मैं तो कहूँगा बहुत ही आशाजनक जवाब दिया. हम तो चाहते हैं ऐसे लोग और हो हमारे संसद में, ताकि ये जो पक्ष है, वैचारिक पक्ष, इतना महत्वपूर्ण है, जो लोग समझते ही नहीं है. जो आपने कहा, सिर्फ सभ्यता नहीं मगर समाज के लिए भी विचार कितने अनिवार्य है, और इसके पीछे कितना त्याग करना पड़ता है. बहुत अच्छी बात कही मुझे, बल्कि आपने छांदोग्य उपनिषद का उद्धृत किया था, तो उसमें भी ये जब सीखने जाते हैं तो जनक राजा ही सिखाते हैं. ऐसा नहीं है कि मतलब जो क्षत्रिय है वही उनको सिखा रहे ब्राह्मण को. तो हमारे यहाँ बहुत ऐसी चीजें हैं, क्योंकि अनुभवी वो है, विचार अनुभव से आता है, अनुभव फिर विचार को पुष्ट करता है. ऐसे वैसे अभी हम थोड़ा सा लेट चल रहे हैं. मैं पंडिता जी, राधा जी का चेहरा देख रहा हूँ, तो मुझे कुछ उसमें कुछ अपराध भाव मैं महसूस कर रहा हूँ कि हम थोड़ा विलंबित गति से चल रहे हैं. लेकिन राकेश जी को सुनने का इतना आनंद आ रहा है, बार बार मिलेंगे भी नहीं, बहुत व्यस्त रहते हैं. मतलब थोड़ी तपस्या के बाद ही हम उनको क्या कहें, उनसे ये वरदान हम प्राप्त कर पाए. मैं तो 2-2.5 साल से मैंने इनको रिक्वेस्ट की, उन्होंने कहा हाँ करूँगा करूँगा, लेकिन वो आज सफल हुआ है। मैं हार्दिक धन्यवाद देना चाहता हूँ आपको, और जैसे मैंने पहले भी कहा था, आपसे कभी यहाँ पधारिएगा और हम आपसे यहाँ भी कुछ करवाना चाहते हैं। दरअसल मेरे मन में एक इच्छा है, 1 से 3 तारीख को हम श्री अरविंद पे एक कॉन्फ्रेंस करने जा रहे हैं, एक अंतर्राष्ट्रीय कॉन्फ्रेंस होगा। विषय बहुत ही रोचक है, इम्पोर्टेंट भी है, श्री अरविंदो एंड द आइडिया ऑफ इंडियाज रेनेसांस। तो अगर आप एक दिन के लिए भी आ सके तो हमारे लिए बहुत अच्छा होगा। 1 से 3 है तो हम इसके बारे में अलग से बात करेंगे, लेकिन अभी तो मैं आपको मेरा शुक्रिया अदा करना चाहता हूँ इंस्टीट्यूट की तरफ से और हम सब लोगों की तरफ से। और आई डोंट नो इफ यू कैन स्टे सर, यू आर मोस्ट वेलकम, अदरवाइज वील मूव टू द नेक्स्ट।
मैं इनका लेक्चर सुनकर ही जाऊंगा।
ओह क्या बात है, वाह वाह, बहुत बढ़िया। सो वील इमीजिएटली गो टू द नेक्स्ट वन। आई वॉन्ट टू से अनुराधा जी, आर मोस्ट वेलकम टू दिस इवेंट। आई डोंट वॉन्ट टू से मच अबाउट यू, बट यू आर वन ऑफ द मोस्ट इंस्पायरिंग संस्कृत टीचर्स अलाइव टूडे। आई नो हाउ यू टीच, इट्स अ वंडरफुल एक्सपीरियंस, एंड यू आर ऑल्सो अ ग्रेट इंटेलेक्चुअल, यू स्टडीड अब्रॉड, यू ग्रो अप इन पॉन्डिचेरी, and I think that your contribution to this Indian Renaissance that we are talking about is second to none. I would request you to start your speech in Sanskrit itself and then switch to any other language that you're comfortable with. You know, I want to say just a few words. You know, I was trying to think about what Sri Aurobindo had to say about Swaraj, because Gandhiji ne to puri kitab likhi Hind Swaraj, 1909. He was on this ship SS Kildonan Castle in November, traveling from Southampton to South Africa, Durban. You know, I've written about it, I won't go into that. But I found a very interesting speech of Sri Aurobindo, which I want to refer to and just talk about 2-3 things about this speech. On 24 January 1908, almost 2 years before Gandhiji wrote Hind Swaraj, Sri Aurobindo gave a speech in Nashik in Maharashtra. Now, nobody knows about this speech. Later, it was published in a small Marathi paper called Nashik Vritta. And then it was translated by the Bombay Presidency Police into English. And we got it from the intelligence abstract. Yes, sir, I found out because it was published in the archives and research bulletin of the Sri Aurobindo Ashram. And only subsequently it made it to the political speeches and writings of Sri Aurobindo in the collected works. So I read this speech again before today because I knew that you were going to talk about Sri Aurobindo. And I just want to read, with everyone's permission, just a couple of lines. I want to remember Sri Aurobindo. He said, you see, today we don't talk in this language anymore. So even before the Uttarpara speech, you know, when he was released from jail, the Alipur bomb trial, in Nashik in 1908, he said, and I quote him, before the speech, in his speech, he said, "Whatever I do is not done by me or of my own accord. My actions are dictated by God. I have hitherto been a writer, not an orator, but circumstances have forced me to try my hand at oratory." Now, you know, I just think about this many times, and I want to remember Sadhguru also. You know, he said, "I have absolutely no idea of what I'm going to say." He said, "Your minds are full and my mind is empty. That's the difference between you and me." So, you know, the point is our minds are so full, we are not able to let some higher consciousness channelize or operate through us. Anyhow. Now, I just want to say one thing which is very applicable to us and to what Rakesh ji said. He said one simple thing. Sri Aurobindo said one simple thing. He said, "Swaraj is to be gained by our own exertions. Swaraj is to be gained by our own exertions." And he said, I'm so surprised how Rakesh ji mentioned the Roman Empire. This is what Sri Aurobindo said. I'm quoting him. "The Roman Empire came to grief with its downfall and they were harassed by savage people. The reason is they had no Swaraj. After a lapse of centuries, they stood on their own legs and established for themselves Swaraj and became happy. So basically, saying Swaraj cannot be given to you. Nobody will give it to you. The sovereign will not give it to you. And today, you know, no political authority will give you Swaraj. If the intellectuals cannot stand up and try to get it, won't get it. And he says, the English value the importance of India, I'm quoting, its possession gives them status. If they once allow India to slip from their grasp, they will become a non-entity. Under such circumstances, it is silly to say that the English will train us and entrust us with Swaraj. By reposing confidence in the English people, we are already reduced to a miserable condition. And in the end, we will become extinct. This is what I say. If you entrust your intellectual Swaraj to the Western Academy, even if it is peopled by Indian expatriates, you will become extinct. Do you mean to say India as an intellectual territory is not the most prized possession of the Western Academy, which has lost India as a physical territory? Do you mean to say that India as an economic territory is not a prized possession of big tech today? If they lose India, they will lose 450 million Facebook followers. They will lose 400 million WhatsApp followers. They will lose 45 million Twitter. India is a very valuable territory. It's the biggest democracy in India. Do you mean to say they will not use your own laws to subvert your own Swaraj? Let us not be naive. Please, I think we have to fight for our own intellectual Swaraj. We have to use whatever means there are. And of course, if there is a favorable political dispensation, we must keep appealing to them. We must keep pressurizing them, not just petition, prayer, and protest. Hum katori leke mantralay mein jaye, wo theek nahi hai. Please, you know, intellectual Swaraj is not given to beggars. It has to be given to people who are self-respecting, who read and write every day. And I respect, you know, people who are willing to read and write every day. This is what I say to even our fellows. Ye aapko jagah di gayi hai padhne likhne ke liye. Aap yahan aake politics karenge to kya fayda? Aap yahan aake bhi wahi kar rahe hain jo aap JNU mein kar rahe hain. Rakesh Sinha ji said something very interesting. He said in India, hum log morcha chalate hain for some civil rights somewhere else, you know, lives matter somewhere else, cancel culture. Main JNU mein tha, main apne vidyarthiyon ko puchta tha, aap Palestinians ke liye morcha nikal rahe hain. Jab Kashmiri pandits ko wahan se bedakhal kar diya gaya, aapne kya kiya? I became very unpopular in JNU because I would ask these questions. See, I would say I'm an intellectual, you give me an intellectual answer, don't give me a political answer. Look at your posters here. Give me one poster which has Kashmiri Pandit. So anyhow, so please let us raise important questions. And with this, I turn it over to Panditaji. Go ahead.
Namo Namaha. Bahu Dhanyavadaha Mohodayaha Bhavataha.
Your voice is breaking up. I'm wondering, are you at IIT Kharagpur now or somewhere else? We expect better connectivity from IIT Kharagpur.
No, I'm at home. Can you hear me?
Now your voice is breaking. I suggest you switch off your video and that may save the bandwidth. I'm sorry to have interrupted you. Go ahead. Please go ahead. आपकी आवाज, योर वॉइस इज ब्रेकिंग अप अनुराधा जी.
I'll just try. Kshamyata.
We are only getting an intermittent sound. Intermittent sound aa rahi hai. There are two options. You can switch off your video to save some bandwidth, or you can rejoin. That's another way. Sometimes that helps. You can rejoin with your phone. We certainly, you know, even if we can sacrifice the video, we want to hear your voice.
So. Better? Is it better now?
Yeah.
Is it better?
Yes, it is.
तर्हि अहं प्रयत्नं करिष्यामि, पुनरपि आरम्भं करिष्यामि. तर्हि बहु धन्यवादाः. भागे प्रोफेसर मकंद परंजपे वर्येभ्यः, प्रोफेसर राजवीर शर्मा महाभागेभ्यः, प्रोफेसर सचिन चतुर्वेदी महाभागेभ्यः, डॉक्टर राकेश सिन्हा महाशयेभ्यः च, प्रोफेसर सी के राजू वर्येभ्यः, सभायां पधारितेभ्यः, विद्वत गोष्ठीभ्यः मित्रेभ्यश्च मम सादर प्रणामान् निवेदयामि. मत्पूर्वं श्रेष्ठानां वक्तृणां प्रस्तावनानि श्रुत्वा वाग विलुप्ता अहम्, तथापि मत प्रदत्त दायित्व निर्वहनार्थं कानिचन वचनानि उपस्थापयितुं प्रयतिष्ये. आरंभे मंत्रोच्चार उच्चारणेन अहम् मम प्रस्तावनां कर्तुं भवताम् अनुमतिं प्रार्थये. ओ शन्नो मित्रशं वरुणः, शन्नो भवत्वर्यमा, शन्न इन्द्रो बृहस्पतिः, शन्नो विष्णुरुरुक्रमः, नमो ब्रह्मणे, नमस्ते वायो, त्वमेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्मासि, त्वामेव प्रत्यक्षं ब्रह्म वदिष्यामि, ऋतं वदिष्यामि, सत्यं वदिष्यामि, तन्मामवतु, तद्वक्तारमवतु, अवतु माम्, अवतु वक्तारम्. ओम शांति शांति शांति. I would like to continue, in fact, by thanking Professor Makand Paranjpe ji for this fantastic opportunity of sharing a few thoughts on the whole concept of Atmanirbhar Bharata. The topic was meant for, I mean, I had presented an abstract for another conference, but it seemed to suit this one. So I was asked to share the same thoughts here. And so I look forward to hearing your feedback on it, and also would be very grateful for any kind of, you know, advice, guidance that you might have on these ideas that I will present here with. So I'd like to share my screen here. I will try and pick up the threads from what has been presented, but as I said that the speakers before me, the eminent speakers before me, have covered so much of ground that my talk would seem a little repetitive, but I hope to be able to add something more to what has been said so far. So I would also like to start by mentioning good news that at IIT Kharagpur, like in a few other IITs, we are now recognizing the importance of the Indian knowledge systems. There, Kharagpur itself, we have recently started the Center of Excellence for Indian Knowledge Systems, where we are trying to bring in awareness and through courses, lectures, workshops, etc., on the invaluable contributions that the Indian tradition has made in the overall development of knowledge across the world as it stands today. So my talk is focusing on Sri Aurobindo's ideas of what would be the Renaissance of India, and what would be the how can we bring back Atmanirbhar Bharata? What would it mean to have that state of national reality? So in his book, The Renaissance in India, Sri Aurobindo says, this Renaissance, this new birth in India, is a fact, must become a thing of immense importance, both to herself and the world. To herself, because of all that is meant for her in the recovery or the change of her time-old spirit, and national ideals. To the world, because of the possibilities involved in the re-arising of a force that is in many respects unlike any other, and its genius very different from the mentality and spirit that have hitherto governed the modern India in mankind, although not so far away perhaps from that which is preparing to govern the future. So one needs to understand why this whole reawakening is so important, not just for ourselves, but for the world. And also that this heartening line at the end where he says that this is going to be the reality or the truth that will govern the future of the world itself. And Sri Aurobindo continues a few pages later. He says that India has been preeminently the land of dharma and the shastra. She searched for the inner truth and law of each human or cosmic activity, its dharma. That found, she labored to cast that into elaborate form and detail, law of arrangement, its application in fact and rule of life. Her first period was luminous with the discovery of the spirit. Her second completed the discovery of the dharma. Her third elaborated into detail the first simpler formulation of the shastra. But none was exclusive. The three elements are always present. And when we talk about what is the spirit of India that we are trying to, when we're talking of Atmanirbhara Bharata, what is the spirit of India that we are trying to revive? Sri Aurobindo says in his Uttarpara speech, it was the first speech that he gave after coming out of his year of seclusion at the Alipur jail. So he says, but what is the Hindu religion? Because he says that this nationalism is the Sanatana Dharma. And therefore, we are talking again now of revitalizing, of re-energizing the Sanatana Dharma. But he brings in a much more universal dimension of this idea of the Sanatana Dharma. He says, what is the Hindu religion? What is this religion which we call Sanatan, eternal? It's the Hindu religion only because the Hindu nation has kept it, because in this peninsula, it grew up in the seclusion of the sea and the Himalayas, because in this sacred and ancient land, it was given as a charge to the Aryan race to preserve through the ages. But it is not circumscribed by the confines of a single country. It does not belong peculiarly and forever to a bounded part of the world. That which we call the Hindu religion is really the eternal religion, because it is the universal religion which embraces all others. If a religion is not universal, it cannot be eternal. A narrow religion, a sectarian religion, an exclusive religion can live only for a limited time and a limited purpose. This is the one religion that can triumph over materialism by including and anticipating the discoveries of science and the speculations of philosophy. The religion which impresses on man closeness of God to us and embraces in its compass all the possible means by which man can approach God. It is the one religion which insists every moment on the truth which all religions acknowledge, that he is in all men and all things, and that in him we move and have our being. It is the one religion which enables us not only to understand and believe this truth, but to realize it with every part of our being. It is the one religion which shows the world what the world is, that it is the Leela of Vasudeva. It is the one religion which shows us how we can best play our part in that Leela, its subtlest laws and its noblest rules. It is the one religion which does not separate life in any smallest details from religion, which knows what immortality is and has utterly removed from us the reality of death. And therefore, in this context of the conference where we are looking at the term Swarajya, I think it also becomes very important to understand the ideas of Swatantriya, Swarajya, and Swasthya together. And what we see that when we are saying these words in the same breath, the term Swa stands out. And therefore, the question, Swa meaning the self, and therefore the very important question to address is, what really is the Swatvam of Bharata? What is the essential truth that has infused every single aspect of her civilizational development across the eons of time? So what we had heard, Sri Aurobindo's definition of the Sanatana Dharma helps us to put into perspective this entire discourse that we are having. And I would like to represent this idea from one of the key concepts of the Vedic tradition, which is the idea of Satyam Ritam Brihat. So the idea of Satya, according to the Vedas, represents the ideal that underlies any existence, the ideal truth underlies any kind of manifestation. When that truth is identified and it is implemented, so what Sri Aurobindo talks of, that the spirit underlying things and then implementing it through dharma. So when the Satya is perceived and implemented through the right action, or the dynamic truth in action, that is when we have the consequence, which is Brihat. I'll give you an example of this. So if I wanted to do a surgery which was required a very fine work, and I needed to buy a glove for my hand, would one ask the person, you know, would one ask one's, you know, the support staff to bring any kind of glove? If the glove is too big, then the work that will happen would be clumsy. If the glove is too tight, then one would be constrained from doing the action. So applying Satyam Ritam to this context, we see that in order to wear the right glove, I have to know the Satya of my hand. Once I know the Satya, the ideal form of my hand, I will then wear a glove which is the right glove, or Rita. And when I'm able to wear the right glove and do the surgery which I have the skills for, I will end up doing the best surgery possible, which is Brihat, or the best consequence. The optimum results are obtained. Now, when I have, when I wear the ideal glove, then my hand is held in the best way possible. This holding of the hand in the best way possible is the concept of dharma, is my understanding of the concept of dharma. So dharma implies the knowledge of Satya, the practice of Rita, and the implied consequence of Brihat. And that's the reason why dharma was regarded as the one word constitution of the civilization across times. And every great thinker of the Indian civilization, and also it was very heartening to hear Professor Chaturvedi and Dr. Sinhaji reiterate the of this Satyam Brihat as well as dharma in their presentations. So the question here is that this dharma that is there, how did it support the entire Bharatiya Jivana Drishti? How was it the very foundation of our entire worldview? And how, and therefore, what is the Satyam in our perception of Atmanirbhara Bharata? So if we are projecting the idea of an Atmanirbhara Bharata, in my humble understanding, first and foremost, it is a vision. So the more clearly we are able to articulate the ideals or the satya underlying all the systems, underlying our governance, underlying our economy, underlying what was the Bharatiya economy. This was already talked about, so I will not delve on it too far. But once we can envision that, so that envisioning is the first requirement. Once that envisioning has happened, it has to be transmitted into the psychological attitude of the population itself. Right now, circumstantially, like I will request you to excuse me for this very strong usage, we are a bastardized mindset. We are neither Indian in our thinking, nor are we British in our thinking. We are somewhere stuck in between, as a result of which a lot of the disjointedness of our systems is evident. So therefore, this Atmanirbhara Bharata has to be a vision that has to percolate into our society as a psychological attitude. Then there has to be the practical preparation of the systems to hold these ideas. And finally, one has to get into the implementable phase of realizing these ideals in manifestation. And so I sort of had a flow chart to try and represent these milestones for an Atmanirbhara Bharata. So right now we are in the situation of a Nirbhara Bharata. And therefore we are Paratantra. We are all the time, what Dr. Sinhaji also mentioned, that we are invariably referring to Western models in all our disciplines of education. So we are completely Paratantra in our mindset. So the first step would be from Nirbhara Bharata to become Atmanirbhara Bharata, which means the first tentative understanding of who we are. From there, we'll achieve some form of Swatantra, which is what, let's say, this government is trying to do where you're talking of Made in India, we are talking of different policies that will try and help to rejuvenate our indigenous systems, knowing things, of knowing who we are, what were our ways of functioning. The next step, I would say, is the Atmanirbhara Bharata. So when I put an R, the A with a capital here, I'm referring to the potential of Bharata, not just the present, hybrid version of India, of Bharata, but the version of Bharata, which is potentially the best of herself. That will give us a greater degree of swatantriya or swatantrata. And from there, in my, again, humble opinion, I think what we need to move towards is the Atma Bhara Bharata, where every system of our, of this nation will go back or will revert to the quest for the infinite behind the finite forms. I think that has been the one hallmark that Sri Aurobindo talks of often in his works. The one hallmark that marks the Indian civilization is the quest for the underlying essence behind everything that is perceived, because that is the one incredible contribution that the Indic civilization in terms of a conceptual reality has offered to the world. And when we are established in Atma Bhara Bharata, I have not yet got clarity on what that would really, what that would mean in terms of a society, what that would mean in terms of systems. But I would envisage that when that happens, then we will live out the truth of our civilizational, our civilizational ethos, which is the Purnata Siddhi will be accomplished. And therefore, Vedic perspectives always focused on this return. So they would say that the essence of becoming Atmanirbhara Bharata was to be Atma Bhara. And the term Veda itself comes from the root Vid, which comes from to know, to be, and to obtain. And therefore, the whole quest of the Vedas was the knowledge to be. Now, this quest happened at an individual level, and the focus of this mission was also to make individuals self-sufficient in their own. So Atmanyevatmana Tushtaha was the goal. How can we be complete in ourselves? Because the more we have completed individuals, the more we have Atmasiddha individuals, the less stress there would be on external systems and governance to manage and all. So this is, I would say, possibly the reality of the Satya Yuga. And we are right now at the other end of the Kali Yuga. But the good news, what I know, is that we are on our way up again. So if we can present these ideas, at least conceptually hold them in our mind, because I believe that the more and more people, more and more of us who are contributing to this thought formations of the Atmanirbhara Bharata, or I would say the Atma Bhara Bharata, the more thought waves we create and the more we create those structures of consciousness, things would percolate into manifested reality much faster. Because unlike the way the rest of the world views progress, we are not a civilization that viewed first material progress alone and then higher progress. We saw the potential of first conceiving it and then manifesting it. And there's a very beautiful aphorism of Sri Aurobindo. He says that the French Revolution took place because there was a rishi on the Himalayas who dreamt of equality, liberty, and fraternity. So that is the power of this conceptual clarity and projections that is very required in today's age. And the reason why we have arrived at our current dominant mindset is something that all of you are very familiar with. But this is just to just to present it again so that there's a reminder, where it was governed by these ideas of Macaulay's, where he said that a single shelf of good European library was worth the whole native literature of India and Arabia, and that the intrinsic superiority of the Western literature is indeed fully admitted by those members of the committee who support the Oriental plan of education. He goes on to say, he says, the literature, Sanskritic and Arabic, inculcates the most serious errors on the most important subjects, including false history, false astronomy, false medicine, in company with a false religion. And then instead he proposed that English is better, because talking of the language that will support the education that he was proposing, He says English is better worth knowing than Sanskrit or Arabic. In order to form a class who may be interpreters between us and the millions whom we govern, a class of persons Indian in blood and color, but English in taste and opinions and morals and in intellect. So, So what we see here is that this was the idea that was the foundation, these ideas rather were the foundations of the entire system of education that we are carrying on beyond our independence period. And whether we like it or not, because again, we belong to a culture that knows the importance of the seed intentions. These intentions, I would say the British have this, the changing of, or replacement of the Indian education system was one of the most brilliant strategies that the English implemented, that is still bearing very, very effective fruits, even, you know, more than 70 years after independence. So if we want to deconstruct this idea or this underlying idea, we have to once more utilize that same strategy to work backwards and re-inculcate or re-infuse into the system of education what was truly Indian. And I think that the present national education policy that was released in 2020 has a lot of hope in that direction. So it says that the knowledge of India will include knowledge from ancient India and its contributions to modern India and its successes and challenges, and a clear sense of India's future aspirations with regard to education, health, environment, etc. I'll not read the rest. But then there has been this focus on Indian knowledge systems, or IKS. And I would like to play on the word I, which normally represents Indian. So just on the whole, Indian knowledge systems has a historical component, it has a geographical component, and it has a cultural component, which is completely in spirit with the plural ethos and the acceptance of diversity, or the seeing of the underlying unity behind the diverse expressions. And the term, the letter I have tried to interpret it, like I said, in these five ways. I said the education is not just about what we teach, but how and why we are teaching it. And I think unless we are very consciously addressing those points, we will somehow again miss the point. It is not about just teaching Indian science instead of, you know, Western science. It's not, in my humble opinion, again, it's not just about doing a surgical implant of one over the other. I believe that the education has to have a fundamentally different approach. So it has to be internalizing versus externalizing. It has to be integral versus partial. It has to be integrated versus compartmentalized. It has to be intuitive versus mental. And it has to be inclusive versus exclusive. And in this context, the ancient education system always emphasized on two kinds of knowledges that had to be imparted: the paravidya as well as the aparavidya. So that we had to they recognized rather that all knowledge that we acquire is transmitted, or rather is mediated through the instrument that is acquiring that knowledge. And if that instrument, which is the human being itself, is imperfect, no matter how sophisticated the external knowledge, it will always fall short of its ideal mark, or it will be misinterpreted. And that's why education had to cater to these two dimensions of the individual and of knowledge. The first was on how we define and fit our instruments so that the lenses through which we are perceiving the world are as transparent as can be and not colored with their biases and judgments, etc., so that the knowledge that we are getting in will have its optimum result. So the apara vidya was the indirect or mediated knowledge, or technical knowledge, because dharma, artha, kama, artha and kama were important. So in order to live life effectively, one had to have technical knowledge, but that technical knowledge could, or the possibilities of that technical knowledge could best be achieved if the instrument acquiring that knowledge was tuned, and tuned to a search for truth. So then the second kind of interpretation of I was integral versus partial. So the again, the underlying view. So the underlying view that the individual is first of all consciousness-based. We are not animals trying to become more refined animals. but retaining all those baseness within us. We do have an animal aspect of us, but we're essentially a multi-layered being of consciousness, and we have to go back to that reality. And that's the whole purpose of the Purusharthas that Professor Chaturvedi emphasized upon. Says we have to, because there is a meaning. Life is not just a random, random experience. There is a directionality to that. And somehow we seem to have culturally forgotten this directionality. And therefore we can engage in acts that are not just degrading to us as human beings, but degrading to us civilizationally. Because we have forgotten that there is a higher purpose. We've forgotten somewhere through the systems that were, that we have passed through, that we need to understand that the whole purpose is to unveil rather than put on more and more layers of darkness around us. So the question koham, and the most liberating idea, soham, I am that. I mean, there cannot be a more liberating destination that is provided to any civilization on earth. And then we have the next one, which is about integrated versus compartmentalized. So the Sanskrit language, for one, is one of those fantastic tools, which by the very nature of the language is integrative in the subconscious programming it does of the human beings. Again, in terms of languages, there is a lot of research, contemporary research happening, that is trying to understand the effect of language on our thinking, that language formats our thinking. If we are using English predominantly, our thinking will acquire certain properties. So there is a scholar called Dr. Lera Boroditsky, who has shown that if you take people from a different culture and make them use their language, but in the structures of another culture, they will start thinking like them. So the Sanskrit language has this incredible synthesizing nature. Again, possibly because of the source of the language, that's another topic that if I start, it will not, it's not so easy to put a brake on. But just this fabulous creation, which integrates the right and left brains, which through poetry, it means something, and it is at the same time solving one of the most challenging mathematical problems, which is how do you make the horse of a chessboard move in every square so that it covers all the squares of the board? So you have this first verse, Thiragasam Sadaradhya Viharakata Mata Sat Paduke Sarasama Rangaraja Padam Naya. And then they created another verse, which was Thita Samaya Rajatpa Gatara Madake Gavi Duran Hansam Sannatada Sadhyata Pakarasara. Correct. So we see that if you place all the letters of the first shloka here, and then you just try to reconstruct the second verse on the chessboard, it will solve that problem. And there are hundreds of such verses. So just have this to show the mind that was that existed and that still continues to exist, was a mind that was able to integrate the scientific component along with the poetic aspects. And the next one is the intuitive versus mental. The intuitive knowledge is something, again, that we have got, we have lost, and therefore we are focusing exclusively on a more linear approach to knowledge. And all of this, so another key idea. So this was just about the education up to here, where I said that, you know, we need to bring back these educational aspects. And I'm wondering if I have, yes, inclusive versus exclusive. That one's not here. So how, because the Indian vision of existence was inclusive. So everything was part of the same source. And therefore we didn't treat nature as other than us, that we need to protect, and because it is other and it needs, you know, our patronage. But we looked after nature because nature, looking after nature meant looking after ourselves. So that, I think, again, can make a huge contribution in the whole discourse of environmentalism. And I have a dear friend, Professor Gina Mukherjee, who's here, and she's trying to also in different ways highlight the South Asian thinking on in the global scenario. And then another key idea of the Vedas was this concept of sacrifice, or the yajna. So what it essentially represented is that we are constantly engaged in this exchange. We are constantly giving our energies to something and receiving something in return. So the question is, what are we giving our energies to? What are we giving our energies to at an individual level, at a collective level, at a national level? Are we offering to those forces, the devas, who are seeking to bring more clarity, enlightenment? Or are we instead offering to those forces of darkness and division? And this concept of the yajna was not just those, naimittika karmas that once in a while one had to perform. What Sri Aurobindo says is that this yajna is happening at a moment to moment. So can we awaken the civilizational conscious to paying attention to the nature of our expressions? I mean, I know that this is possibly a very ideal cry or an ideal proposition, but I think that if one is one has a lot of clarity at the satya level, then at some time it will be a matter of time before it finds its way into the material reality. And then Sri Aurobindo says that in order to do this, we offer the yajna. In that yajna, we offer, we have to light agni, which is the common will. In that, we offer the grita, our clarified thoughts. There we offer the mantra or the word of truth. And then finally, that we are offering the soma rasa, which is the delight of existence. So why should we as a nation engage in this tremendous churning of our swatvam? The purpose for that would be so that we are once more living a more liberated existence rather than an existence of, bonded thinking and being. And therefore, Sri Aurobindo, because he spoke of the Aryan, he says that it is important for everybody, not just the Indian people, but everybody needs to become an Aryan once more. And he says that the word Arya comes from the root Ar, which means to be a real warrior. Self-perfection is the aim of his conquest. Therefore, what he conquers, he does not destroy, but ennobles and fulfills. He knows what the body, life, mind are given him in order to attain to something higher than they. Therefore, they must be transcended and overcome, their limitations denied, the absorption of their gratifications rejected. For always the Aryan is a worker and a warrior. He spares himself no labor of mind or body, whether he seek the highest or to serve it. He avoids no difficulty. He accepts no cessation from fatigue. Always he fights for the coming of that kingdom within himself and in the world. And another idea of the, another root of the term Arya is to cultivate. So whoever cultivates the field that the Supreme Spirit has made for him, his earth of plenty within and without, does not leave it barren or allow it to seed, but labors to extract from it its full yield, is by that effort an Aryan. So the Aryan is whoever thus aspires, labors, battles, travels, ascends the hill of being, is the Aryan, from Arya, Arya, Ari, with the various senses to toil, to fight, to climb, to rise, or rise, to travel, to prepare the sacrifice. For the work of the Aryan is a sacrifice, which is at once a battle and an ascent, a journey, a battle against the power of darkness. Into the infinity of things. And this entire aspiration of the Vedic Rishis was, in a sense, couched or embedded in this mantra of the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, where it says, Asato ma sad gamaya, tamaso ma jyotir gamaya, mrityor ma amritang gamaya, om shanti, shanti, shanti. Very typically, this verse is translated as, lead me from false to truth, lead me from darkness to light, lead me from death to immortality. But understanding Sanskrit grammar offers us a little shade of a difference and a significant difference. Yes. So when you say lead me from falsehood to truth, from darkness to light, from, it's as if they're two different states. But here we are talking of another meaning which says lead me to the truth of falsehood, lead me to the light of darkness, lead me to the immortality of death, which means that behind the very forms of the negatives, if one pierces deeper within, one can arrive at its true structures. And the one of the aspirations of this civilization also was to experience Brahma once again. So I try to make a smart acronym of it, which is being real or really reconnected after hearing the mantra of the national Atman. And therefore, we are at an unprecedented moment in the evolution of our civilization as we are rewriting our system of education, where it says again in the national education policy that we need a value-based education. Value-based education will include the development of humanistic, ethical, constitutional, and universal values of truth, righteous conduct, truth, satya, righteous conduct, dharma, peace, shanti, asti, love, prema, non-violence, ahimsa, scientific temper, citizenship values, and also life skills. Lessons in seva, service, and participation in community service programs will be considered an integral part of a holistic education. And finally, to close here, I have a proposition that we are presently reassessing the progress of the nation on the basis of GDP, which is the gross dharma domestic product. So can we reassess our measurements on the development to go from Atmanirbhara Bharata to Atma Bhara Bharata on another definition of GDP, which could be the gross dharma practice? Or can we think of them parallelly? Can we collectively rewrite a dharma shastra for the 21st century? And the way forward to help us go from Atmanirbhara Bharata to Bharata would be possibly to rewrite this dharma shastra for the 21st century, to reestablish Swarajya concepts in education itself. And can we redefine once more, as I said, the GDP alongside existing GDP? The former will account for the development of the socio-cultural wealth, while the latter will focus on the national material profit. It will allow a national stock-taking mechanism by the creation of a clear map action with greater degrees of accountability at individual and collective levels. This would help us to re-establish an inherent decentralized self-regulating mechanism. Can we link so connect ancient dreams? Go to close, and I will close by borrowing directly the words of my guru, Sri Aurobindo. This is the last paragraph of the Uttarpara speech, where he says that this word that has been put into my mouth to speak today, what I intended to speak has been put away from me. And beyond that, what is given to me, I have nothing to say. It is only the word that is spoken to me that I can speak to you. That word is now finished. I spoke before this force in me, and I said that this movement is not a political movement. It's not a religion, a creed, a faith. I say it again today, but I put it in another way. I say no longer that nationalism is a creed, a religion, a faith. I say that it is Sanatana Dharma, which for us is nationalism. This Hindu nation was born with the Sanatana Dharma. With it, it moves, and with it, it grows. When the Sanatana Dharma declines, then the nation declines. And if the Sanatana Dharma were capable of perishing with the Sanatana Dharma, it would perish. The Sanatana Dharma, that is nationalism. This is the message that I have to speak. And just a final wrap up, a reminder of what the Sanatana Dharma was in the vision of Sri Aurobindo. This is the one religion that can triumph over materialism by including and anticipating the discoveries of science and the speculations of philosophy. It is the one religion which impresses on mankind the closeness to God of God to us and embraces it in its compass, all the possible means which man can approach God. It is the one religion which says every moment on the truth which all religions acknowledge, that he is in all men and all things, and that in him we move and have our being. It is the one religion which enables us not only to understand and believe the truth, but to realize it with every part of our being. It is the one religion which shows the world what the world is, that it is the Leela of Vasudeva. It is the one religion that shows us how we can best play our part, its subtlest laws and its noblest true rules. It is the one religion which does not separate life in any smallest detail from religion, which knows what immortality is and has utterly removed death. This could not be a more striking note in the context of the present pandemic. And therefore, the call to all of us, which says, O Amrita Sutra, O children of immortality, Krinvansh from Arya, make the world, or make the world of us. Dhanyavada.
Thank you, Panditaji, for a wonderful presentation. Please do send us your slideshow. It'll be in our record. I want to throw this open now. You know, anybody who wishes to ask a question or reflect on everything that has happened here so far today, because it's like an open session. I just wanted to say that this very institute is on the premises of what was once the Viceregal Lodge, from where the British ruled their vast empire for about 7 or 8 months a year. I think to talk about Swaraj from this place is very important. A message should go out that the project of decolonization is not complete. I was struck by one or two things you said. I loved the idea of gross dharmic productivity or gross dharmic GDP practice, gross dharmic practice. It's precisely these things we need. When I went to Bhutan, they said, we believe not in GDP, but gross happiness, GHP, gross happiness.
Gross national happiness.
Gross national, GNP, gross national
GNS.
Happiness. Gross national, GNP, gross national, GNH, sorry, GNH, gross national happiness. So we absolutely need to tweak these received concepts. And certainly, you know, we say that sukhasya mulam artham and arthasya mulam dharmam. So obviously, mool to dharmi hai, mool tattva to dharmi hai. But what I really liked is the emphasis on what we understand by swa. When we say swaraj, what is it that will rule? Will it be our asuric elements? That's why you brought in the idea of the Arya. You see, we are a mixed bag, all of us. And in my experience, this pandemic has been a huge crisis in a variety of ways. I mean, health crisis, we know, economic crisis, we know. But it's been a psychic crisis. I found perfectly normal type of people becoming so asuric. They've become, or the monster in them was unleashed. And there are perfectly normal, ordinary people who have done heroic things, which was not expected of them. So the moment of crisis, you know, reveals the true nature of your soul's orientation. So what is the orientation of us Bharatas as a nation? This, you know, Bharat Varsha, what is the orientation of our nation? I think this is the thing that Sri Aurobindo was trying to point to. And this is what Swami Vivekananda was trying to awaken. You know, like a pran pratishthapana of a tamasic and moribund nation sleeping and, you know, having drunk the waters of, you know, sort of hopeless degradation. Yahan tak ke gene pool khatam ho raha tha. People were dying at 29, you know. So we have to go into this very deeply. So the point Sri Aurobindo says, every nation is a soul. Every nation has a soul. So when we say Swaraj, what we are saying is that the soul of the nation should be awakened so that it is offered as an oblation in the yajna. Because the soul cannot be purified, the psychic being cannot be discovered until you are able to offer as oblation all the obstructive tendencies within you. So, you know, if all the vasana, somebody was saying vasana comes from that smell, you know, the smell. So yesterday we had another meeting and Professor Hara, I hope he's here. So he said, mujhe jo manushya hai, uski gandh se mujhe, wo mujhe achhi lagti hai. Because what he's saying is, in COVID, people are divided. Social distancing has divided people. So I said, adhetaon ki bhi ek khas gandh hoti hai. And then I said, Rajveer ji, he was the fellows council representative. So he never let it become durgandh. Wo sugandh unhone banai rakhi. So ye jo gandh hai, the vasana. So this is the point that I'm trying to make, that the swa and the swaraj has to be purified. The daily yajna, the offering of oneself to that higher force, whatever you want to call it, you know, you can use the Gayatri mantra, You can use some other mantra, you know, you can say Om Anandamayi Chaitanyamayi, you know, Satyamayi Paramayi, whatever mantra you like, that offering. But the collective soul of the nation can also achieve Swaraj only through that purification. And as you said, if you're standing on Sat, then, because I think I said earlier, hypocrisy and all, one of our biggest national flaws, if not vices, is a daily hypocrisy. In the constitution, you'll say everybody is equal, but in practice, nobody is equal. Everything is coming with some patch, some tag, some identitarian or some other compensatory mechanism, so that you can never flourish. So the final thing I want to say, what I got from your presentation, is reconnecting with your past, unlocking the potential of Indian knowledge systems, you know, exploring the Swa is not a binding in the sense that it is not a burden, you know, but it is liberating. So you're really inviting us, in other words, you're saying to us, look, this journey of Swarajya, it's a joyous and liberating journey. It's a journey of self-discovery. It's a journey of unlocking your potential. It's a journey in which all the powers of your being and self are allowed free access. You mentioned intuition, you know, like someone was saying that, okay, what kind of intellect would you like? So the answer was, I want a very sharp intellect. So he said, that's the problem. Your intellect is like a very sharp knife. And you go on stabbing everything with it. Sometimes you need a needle, because if you've cut yourself, you can't sew back, you can't suture it with a knife. So our civilization has been cut. There is a rent. You know, you have to suture it. For that, this knife of intellect is not enough. You know, the love, the intuition, the compassion, etc. These things have to be unlocked. And that vibration of the mantra that you mentioned, which can awaken that higher consciousness. Unfortunately, nobody talks of consciousness. That word is some kind of taboo word, you know. And they'll say, oh, you're going into some mumbo jumbo. And the experiments in free progress, you see, these have to be taken to every school. So I always say now, this 12th class examination, unbundling is a great boon for India. Unbundle it. Even the NEP, unbundle it. Don't impose one size fits all. I think you can have regulation at the lower levels. Certainly unity, not uniformity. But as you grow higher, you need more and more freedom. Sri Aurobindo says that human beings aspire for freedom to grow. But we are so afraid of freedom that we only exchange one shackle for another. And I think that's the tragedy of the incomplete project of Swarajya. We got rid of one shackle and immediately put another. Ek bedi se dusri bedi humne le li. Anyhow, with these words, I found one question which has come from your own friend, Jenia Mukherjee ji. She says something about incorporating Atmanirbhar. Okay, Atmanirbhar, I wanted to say, Atmanirbhar, what is the opposite? Can it be Paranirbhar? Because the Atma includes the Para. Your MPhil dissertation was on this. Self and other to hai ni. We don't have self and other. We have only different selves. These are all different selves, which are in fact one self. But for appearance purposes, we say these are different selves. So you are also myself. She's also myself. He's also myself. He's not my other. He's myself. He's another version of myself. So Raja Rao famously said, India has no enemies. India only has adversaries. So she's saying that we are curbing customary practices, even in wetlands, fisheries, eco-communities. Atmanirbhar is envisioned by Indian seers, can flourish and thrive as an all-comprehensive doctrine across sectors and along social communities. Absolutely, Atmanirbhar doesn't mean shutting your doors, not importing, blocking trade. Swadeshi Jagran Manch is not about producing everything. The whole world is interconnected. today the labor, the barriers to labor are also not as effective, visa regimes, because you can sit here and work for a company anywhere in the world, etc. So these are very deep things to think about. But now it is open. The first priority is to our fellows. If any of our fellows wishes to ask a question, they may ask a question. Second is to our participants of the conference themselves. And third is to anybody else who's joined. But we can always jumble up the order. I just want to respect the fellows of this institute if they have something to say first. Please go ahead. You can send the question in the chat box, or you can let me know, raise your hand and speak, but briefly, no lectures, please. Yes, Professor Raju.
Well, you gave a very impassioned talk. I was just wondering about one thing. Why do you think that Macaulay was peculiar to India? Same colonial education went everywhere in the world. You go to Lebanon, French education, the French colony, but the syllabus, curriculum, it's exactly the same. So if you can't find the cause, if you keep thinking cause is Macaulay, you'll never find the answer to the solution to the problem. No, it's like you're ill, you don't know the cause of the illness, how will you find the remedy? So there was colonization everywhere else. Is anything being taught differently anywhere else? Even in your institution, IIT Kharagpur, which is decolonizing.
I'm not sure, Professor Raju, you have fully understood the question. What is the question? Are you saying that the equivalent of Macaulay operated in all colonial societies? Is that what you're saying?
Let me make it clear that our education system is not due to Macaulay. He was just an instrument. The education system comes from the church, and it was the church education system which was globalized by colonialism, by French colonialism, by Belgian colonialism, by whatever kind of colonialism you can think of, by Dutch and so on. So all those people, it was church education. So let's not just blame Macaulay. Let's find the actual cause. Look at the syllabus. It's the syllabus of British universities. And what kind of syllabus did they have? They were all church institutions. So was the University of Paris. So were all the Dutch universities. Many of them still are.
So was Harvard. So was Harvard.
So was Harvard. So was Harvard. I just gave a talk in Tübingen and Pretoria, where I showed this image of the church tower at Harvard. If you go to Harvard Square, there is this big tower, and it had to dominate the landscape because no building was allowed to be taller. You go to Finland, you find the same thing. The prime minister's house of the king's palace has to be lower than that of the archbishop. So I'm saying
absolutely. We got it. Now, in fact, The so-called secular education was a translation of church doctrines.
Exactly.
Devoid of the theological claptrap. So
it is not devoid of the theological claptrap, because if you are looking at formal mathematics, it is theological claptrap.
The theology was smuggled under a different.
Yes.
Right.
Not openly. It was hidden and passed on to us, like it is done in our class 9 school text. There was a Euclid. Greeks did something. They never did it. Euclid didn't exist. They never did it. But it was the church theology which was pushed in. The church theology is pushed in the form of
secularism was also an invention from within a certain intellectual culture.
I agree. There were all these things, and in the US something happened
This is a challenge for us, because when we talk about Sanatan Dharma, and at least in the Uttarpada speech, Sri Aurobindo clearly says what he means by it. It's not any sectarian. But we are also in the danger of imposing our own version of a church education, except with Hindu terminology, which will not liberate us. So I think that what I'm trying to say is we are very afraid of An open mind is a matter of great fear for most societies, most political dispensations. An open mind is a dangerous thing.
Agreed.
Everybody's Agreed. Trying to regulate, control. The only debate is who's going to control it, whose tower is going to be higher. So I'm afraid that...
Yeah. May I intervene?
No, I'm saying that what we should be afraid of is the substitution of one set of manacles by another.
I agree.
And I'm not persuaded by the logic that, oh, ye hamare saath kabhi nahi ho sakta. Please don't congratulate yourself that there is something genetic about Hindus that will make them impervious. That will make them impervious, you know, to the, what should I say, to the deadly drawbacks of other races. No, hum log bhi usi tarah, and please never think that we didn't persecute people for their beliefs. We also did it, maybe not so much. What happened is people were thrown out and 15-20 kilometers ahead they formed their own ashram usually, but it was not always so pleasant, and there were very many pitched battles where different faith traditions, if you want to call them that, different ideologies were competing to capture state power as the Rajguru. And in Tamil Nadu, the Shaivites drove out. They drove out the Vaishnavites. That's why they went to Melkote and elsewhere. We must not airbrush or whitewash our own selves. And
I'm not saying that.
I'm not saying you are, Professor Raju.
Yeah.
I'm saying this to the enthusiasts who want to substitute one.
I agree.
One disc operating system by another. That's all. So
yeah.
Go ahead, Anuradha ji. Hara Sahib also wants to say something. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was just wanting to add to that, that I think that it's not just been a physical discrimination or, you know, thing that has happened. But it continues today also. So if we are genuine to our swatvam, which says sarvam khalu divinity, then any kind of discrimination in terms of birth or in terms of profession, in terms of anything, is completely antagonistic to the essential spirit of the Sanatana Dharma. And I think it is hypocrisies that you were mentioning. That needs to be carefully investigated and done away with.
No. What I'm saying is, when you say that, everybody will agree. But when you say do away with reverse discrimination, they won't agree. See, this is our hypocrisy. Our hypocrisy, when you say, my problem is this, what we have got ourselves into. See, when you say...
I get it. Also, so discrimination is both. It's not just I will articulate what you're hesitating to say. It's not about, you know, higher caste having discrimination against the lower caste, but even in systems, if the people, maybe due to reservations or whatever, discriminate against the higher caste, even that is equally problematic.
No, but nobody will agree with you.
No, I understand. But I'm saying that is what any kind of discrimination, irrespective of the direction should be addressed.
No, that is why I'm saying that you will have to mount an interrogation which is wide-ranging, and it will not result in a simplistic comfort zone. You go to Tamil Nadu, and what have they done there? They have institutionalized a Dravidianism, you know, which is very dangerous in some ways, but yet their social delivery is better than that of the other states. Look at their parameters for education. So what I'm trying to say is, as intellectuals, there's no dodge. All I'm saying is, I'm not disagreeing or agreeing with anybody in particular. I'm only saying that our task, if you want to rise to the occasion, our task is going to be wide-ranging, multidimensional, and it has to be informed by satya or sattva, as you said, because you can't exchange one set of manacles by another. You can't say my handcuffs are better because they have a different hue, but your handcuffs are bad. So if you want to liberate the human spirit, then there's no easy answer. It's not a West versus East. That's my point. It's not a past versus present. You know, it's not a Hindu versus Muslim. It's not a church versus non-church. It's much more complicated. That is all I'm trying to propose.
In a nutshell, it is Asat versus Sat. That is
if I may come in, I think the discussion got derailed a bit. We were talking about specifically about education, right? Because we are talking about decolonization and you mentioned Macaulay. It's talking about that. And I think it is a very clear-cut case of the West versus the rest.
Again, the dangers that we have is when we homogenize the West and homogenize the East and we attribute...
I'm not homogenizing. I'm saying we have church education. We are not homogenizing. I'm aware of all those social science bickering. I am talking about church education. All right, please tell me what have we done to change church education?
Okay, Harasa, let's move on.
सर प्रोफेसर राजू की तकलीफ समझ में आती है मुझे बार बार. ये केवल मैथमेटिक्स में नहीं हुआ, ये ज्ञान के सभी अनुशासनों में हुआ. मुझे मार्क ब्लॉक की एक पंक्ति याद आती है कि ईसाइयत इतिहासकारों का धर्म है और मार्क ब्लॉक बड़े हिस्टोरियन. इतनी हुआ तो सभी ज्ञान, लेकिन एक बात की ओर हमारा ध्यान नहीं जाता, वो उसकी ओर मैं खींचना चाहता हूँ कि राष्ट्रीय आंदोलन की एक प्रवृत्ति के रूप में वी उपनिवेशीकरण और ज्ञान के पुनरुत्थान की मुहिम शुरू हुई थी. शुरू महात्मा गांधी के नेतृत्व में हुई, गुजरात विद्यापीठ की स्थापना की गई, काशी हिंदू विश्वविद्यालय खोला गया, रविन्द्रनाथ टैगोर ने शांति निकेतन बनाया, बहुत सारे देशज सरोकारों वाले विद्वानों को उन्होंने एकत्र किया जिनकी औपचारिक शिक्षा भी नहीं थी, क्षितिमोहन सेन, कई लोग एकत्रित हुए, मुनिजी विजय. लेकिन आजादी के तत्काल बाद इस पूरी पीढ़ी को नए बुद्धिजीवियों ने विस्थापित कर दिया. अब विडंबना यह है कि हम में से उनके नाम भी नहीं पता हम लोगों को. बहुत सारे लोग ऐसे थे जिन्होंने ये काम किया. अभी सिन्हा जी कह रहे थे कि राजस्थान में अकेले एक व्यक्ति ने, मुनिजी विजय नाम है उनका, उन्होंने 5,000 पांडुलिपियां विभिन्न क्षेत्रों में दफ्तर बनाकर एकत्र की. और वो अब आप उदयपुर का जो पूरा प्राचीन पुरातत्व, ये राजस्थान प्राच्य विद्या प्रतिष्ठान है, वो एक सॉइल कंजर्वेशन ऑफिस, सॉइल कंजर्वेशन में एक क्वार्टर में कर दिया गया, एक्सेस कर दिया गया. तो ये उन देशज सरोकारों वाले विद्वानों के काम को मुझे लगता है सामने लाया जाना चाहिए. क्षितिमोहन सेन थे, सुनीति कुमार चाटुर्जिया थे, मोती चंद थे, मुनि जिन विजय थे, राहुल सांकृत्यायन थे, हजारी प्रसाद द्विवेदी थे. मुझे लगता है कि देशज भारतीय ज्ञान के पुनरुत्थान के लिए इन्होंने जो प्रयत्न किए, इन्होंने जो बहुत सारा साहित्य सामने लाकर रखा, पूरी भारतीय साहित्य की बुनियाद रखी. लेकिन आजादी के तत्काल बाद अब नाम तो लेना ठीक नहीं है उस किसी विचारधारा के वर्चस्व वाले. पूरी एक पीढ़ी आई, पूरी की पूरी पीढ़ी, और उस पूरी पुरानी पीढ़ी को उन्होंने विस्थापित कर दिया, जबकि बुनियादी स्रोत उन्होंने एकत्र किए थे सारे के सारे, भारतीय साहित्य के भी और ज्ञान के.
बहुत अच्छा कहा
सर. आप कह रहे थे कि आत्मनिर्भर भारत का ऑपोजिट क्या हो सकता है. मुझे एक किताब स्मरण आती है, उसका हिंदी अनुवाद हुआ है, पंगु मस्तिष्क. वो किताब है सुशांत गुणतिलक की, श्रीलंकन हिस्टोरियन है वो, फिलोसफर है, और बहुत शानदार किताब है. ये हमारे सबके मस्तिष्क तो हम देखिए चेतन संस्कार और स्मृति से मुक्त होना बहुत मुश्किल था. हमारे मस्तिष्क तो पंगु है, इसमें तो कोई संदेह ही नहीं. हम चाहे या ये हमारी इच्छा पर निर्भर नहीं करता, वो हमारे संस्कार और स्मृति में है, हमारे ब्लड में कहीं कहीं. तो उससे मुक्त होना बहुत मुश्किल काम है. आप उधर कहिए तो वो आपको अपने उधर नहीं मानेंगे, इधर कहिए तो आप वो आपको अपना नहीं मानेंगे. मतलब बीच वाली स्थिति है. आप थोड़ा सा कहकर देखिए, वो कहेंगे ये तो वो हो गया, अब नाम नहीं लूंगा मैं. अब बहुत सारी चीजें हैं सर, ये बहुत मुश्किल काम है इससे मुक्त होना. और वी उपनिवेशकरण की प्रक्रिया कोई बहुत जल्दी 2 साल में 3 साल में खत्म हो जाएगी, बहुत मुश्किल काम है सर वो.
आपने बहुत अच्छा कहा, इसमें पीढ़ी दर पीढ़ी हमें कोशिश जारी रखनी पड़ेगी। और आपने ये बहुत दूसरी अच्छी बात ये कही कि हमारी विडंबना क्या है कि हम बुद्धिजीवी नहीं है, रादर हम बुद्धिनिष्ठ नहीं, हम बुद्धिजीवी है। ये हमारे लिए एक आजीविका का साधन है और बहुत ही न्यून या मध्यम स्तर के बुद्धिजीवी हम निर्माण करते हैं और उसी से हमें विलास हमें उसी से मिलता है कि ये मीडियोक्रिटी चले और ये छोटी छोटी चीज़ों पे हम विवाद करें, लेफ्ट राइट अपने यही झगड़े रहें। अब देखिए किसी भी विश्वविद्यालय में आपको पदोन्नति के लिए क्या करना है, छापने की आवश्यकता नहीं है, आपको किसी पक्ष से जुड़ना पड़ेगा और वही जद्दोजहद सियासीकरण इससे इसी में हमारा पतन हो रहा है। हम दूसरों को क्यों दोषी ठहरा रहे हैं? हमने जो वातावरण बनाया है आज़ादी के बाद वो तो बिल्कुल हमारे कहिए सत्व कहिए हमारे संस्कार कहिए जो पुराने हैं उससे विपरीत है। अच्छा दूसरी चीज टीचर यानी क्या, एक आसान जिंदगी, हाँ प्रतिष्ठा समाज में, मेहनत करने की आवश्यकता नहीं, यही एक प्रचलित हो चुका है। टीचर बनना इसका मतलब क्या है, कोई आपको हटाता नहीं है, सेवंथ पे कमीशन के बाद तनख्वाह भी बड़ी अच्छी है, मेहनत करने वाली नौकरी नहीं समझते इसको। लेकिन इस क्षेत्र में जो वैचारिक क्षेत्र है उसमें कई ज्यादा मेहनत करनी पड़ती है, किसी भी चीज एक ग्रंथ को समझना कितनी मेहनत करनी पड़ती है। परसों हमारा अभिनव गुप्ते है, मैं तंत्रालोक पढ़ने लगा, मैंने सोचा कि एक साल से मैं पढ़ता तो कुछ कहीं पहुंच जाता, मतलब कितनी मेहनत करनी पड़ती है। यहाँ तो हम आलस भी हमारे में बहुत है, तमस है, तो मैं आपकी बात मानता हूँ। लेकिन अब ये पंडिता जी हैं, इनको निराशाजनक बात बिल्कुल पसंद नहीं है, तो वो कहेंगी देखिए जहाँ अंधकार है उसके बीच ही प्रकाश है ना, जहाँ मृत्यु है उसी में अमृतत्व है। तो वो यही कहते हैं जो सावित्री में आखिरी सीन है, तो जो 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 मृत्यु है यमराज है वो इतनी बड़ी उनकी उनका बड़ा आकार है लेकिन वो एक क्षण में बिखर जाता है जब सावित्री को आत्मबोध होता है, तो इस तरह की बात है। तो वो ये कहना चाहती हैं, एक तो काम होगा जो सदियों तक चलेगा, सालों साल चलेगा, लेकिन एक काम है जो एक अभी करिए, अभी कीजिए, अभी अभी कीजिए, अभी आहुति दीजिए, इस तरह का काम भी करना चाहिए। और हमने किसी को ये सिखाया नहीं है कि ये हो सकता है कि आज अभी इसी वक्त हम एक संकल्प ले सकते हैं, जैसे अधिष्ठान होता है कि देखिए मेरी चोटी तो नहीं है लेकिन मैं जब तक ये ग्रंथ नहीं समझूंगा तब तक ये मैं चोटी बांध के रखूंगा, ये यहाँ पे मैंने एक कील लगाई है, ये चोटी वहां पे मैं उसको बांध के रखूंगा। ये ऐसे लोग रियाज करते थे, नींद आते ही चोटी वहां चली जाती थी और फिर सितार बजाने लगते थे। ये सच्ची बात है, ऐसे रियाज तो हमने नहीं किया, किसी बुद्धिजीवी ने ऐसा रियाज नहीं किया, बहुत कम। राकेश सिन्हा जी आर्काइव में सुबह शाम रहते थे, ऐसे बहुत कम मिलेंगे और उन्हीं से हमें अपेक्षा होगी कुछ ना कुछ। खैर तो अब समय भी कम होते जा रहा है, किसी और को कुछ कहना है तो प्लीज कुछ क्षणों में कह दीजिए, अपनी अपनी बात कहिए, प्रश्न सवाल जवाब का समय खत्म हो चुका है, अपनी अपनी बात कह दीजिए 30 सेकंड में, और प्लीज प्लीज अपनी अपनी बातें कह दीजिए, जो कहना चाहते हैं आप प्लीज अपनी बातें कह दीजिए, बहुत ही संक्षिप्त में, बहुत ही संक्षिप्त में। कल दोबारा हम मिलेंगे, 10 बजे हमें मिलना है। कल का सत्र क्या है मैं आपको थोड़ा सा बता दूं, और तब तक आपको जो कहना है, तो सत्र का आरंभ 10 बजे हो रहा है और इसके अध्यक्ष होंगे विख्यात हमारे प्राध्यापक और विद्वान बुद्धिजीवी प्रोफेसर राधा वल्लभ त्रिपाठी जी, वाइस चांसलर रह चुके हैं राष्ट्रीय संस्कृत संस्थान के और बहुत ही उदार चरित्र के विद्वान हैं, हमारे यहाँ डिस्टिंग्विश लेक्चर भी दे चुके हैं, फेलो भी रह चुके हैं। इन्होंने भारतीय संवाद और विवाद की परंपरा पे बहुत अच्छी किताब लिखी है, सिर्फ 2-3 किताब इस थीम पे लिखी गई है, उनमें से एक उनकी किताब है। और स्पीकर्स तो बहुत बढ़िया हैं, प्रोफेसर शशि प्रभा कुमार, जो मैं तो समझता हूँ विश्व की वो वैशेषिक दर्शन की सबसे प्रथम अग्रणी विदुषी जी हैं, मैं उनको दीदी कहता हूँ, तो वो कहेंगी जेएनयू में संस्कृत सेंटर को उन्होंने संचालित किया कई वर्ष, फिर वाइस चांसलर बनी सांची विश्वविद्यालय में। प्रोफेसर दीप्ति त्रिपाठी जी जो दिल्ली यूनिवर्सिटी में संस्कृत सेंटर की हेड रह चुकी हैं। ये पहला हमारा सत्र होगा 10 बजे, प्लीज़ जुड़ जाइए। दूसरे बहुत अच्छे अच्छे सत्र आप पढ़ सकते हैं, फिर नंद कुमार जी अध्यक्षता करेंगे, रतन शारदा जी भी बोलेंगे, प्रफुल्ल केतकर जी, तो प्लीज़ आप लोग कल जुड़ जाइए हमसे कृपया, और अपने मित्रों को भी जो सीरियस लोग हैं उनसे भी कहिए। अभी किसी को भी कुछ भी कहना हो संक्षिप्त में कह दें, और फिर मैं अंत में राजवीर जी से कहूंगा सत्र को समाप्त करें वो अपने कुछ आशीर्वचनों के साथ। सो हमारे बुजुर्ग हैं तो वही आखिरी उन्हीं की बात मैं सुनूंगा, हम सब सुनेंगे सिर्फ मैं नहीं, तो दूसरे किसी को कुछ कहना हो तो प्लीज कहिए। अनिल तिवारी जी हैं, लावण्या जी हैं, महीधर प्रसाद जी को मैं देख रहा हूँ, इनको तो मैं जानता हूँ, दूसरे भी हैं जो मैं उनको ठीक से जानता नहीं हूँ, कुछ भी किसी को कुछ कहना हो तो प्लीज कहिए, कोई पाबंदी नहीं है, अपने मन की बात कह दीजिए। हाँ जी कहिए
जी। प्रणाम सर, आप सबको बहुत बहुत नमस्कार।
अच्छा कौन, अच्छा अनिल जी, मैं तो देख रहा हूँ कि संजीव चोपड़ा जी भी जुड़ गए हैं, ये तो हमारे बहुत आनंद की बात है, तो आपका स्वागत है सर, आप अनम्यूट कर लीजिए। सो माय रिक्वेस्ट इज आफ्टर प्रोफेसर तिवारी स्पीक्स आई विल रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर संजीव चोपड़ा हु वाज द आउटस्टैंडिंग डायरेक्टर ऑफ लबसना, अ डियर पर्सनल फ्रेंड एंड अ ग्रेट राइटर, अ ग्रेट लीडर and a great reader. Being a great reader is very rare, but he's a great reader. So I will invite him in a moment. But first, Dr. Anil Tiwari ji from Jammu University, Professor of Philosophy. Go ahead.
जी सर, मैं श्री माता वैष्णो देवी विश्वविद्यालय जो कटरा में है उसमें।
हाँ जी हाँ जी, मैं उसके academic committee में था, sorry for the wrong, मैं उसके academic committee में था जब राजेंद्र जी उसके चेयरमैन, बोर्ड ऑफ चेयरमैन थे, द फाउंडर ऑफ एचसीएल टेक पवार जी, राजेंद्र पवार जी के नेतृत्व में जो एकेडमिक कमेटी का थी उसमें मैं शामिल था, सॉरी गो अहेड।
जी जी, ये मेरा सौभाग्य है कि जब 2007 में मैं इस विश्वविद्यालय में साक्षात्कार के लिए आया था तो आप उस कमेटी में थे और आपने मुझे अपना आशीर्वाद दिया। मैं सबको प्रणाम करता हूँ। भारतीय परंपरा की बात हो रही है, भारतीय परंपरा में शिक्षा की बात हो रही है, इसमें मेरा अपना जो व्यक्तिगत अनुभव है उसको मैं एक मिनट में शेयर करना चाहूँगा। वास्तव में हम जब पढ़ते हैं या कोई भी बात सोचते हैं तो उस समय हम गले से सर के बीच में होते हैं, और आप देखिए कि जब हम बहुत गुस्सा होते हैं या बहुत ज़्यादा कुछ इस तरह से नेगेटिव थॉट में होते हैं तो हम सिर्फ यहीं होते हैं और पूरे शरीर में कहीं नहीं होते। ये चीज़ मैंने अपने अनुभव से देखा कि हम अगर सिर से निकल करके अपने को रिलीज करें, मुक्त करें और एक बार पूरे शरीर में होने की अगर कोशिश करें और ये रोज करें, तो जैसे आपने कहा कि जो हमारे सकारात्मक विचार होते हैं वो बढ़ते हैं, ये मैंने खुद अपने अंदर ये अनुभव किया है, और हम इस समय रोज ये प्रयास करते हैं कि सिर से निकल करके हम पूरे शरीर में एक बार होने का अनुभव करें। और भारतीय परंपरा में बौद्ध परंपरा है जो विपश्यना के बारे में बात करती है, वो योग परंपरा में हम सिर्फ आसन की बात नहीं करते हैं बल्कि बहुत सारी चीजें हैं, तो शिक्षा में इन सब की जरूरत है। और आपने कहा कि जैसे हम लोग एक तरह से काम चोरी वाले प्रवृत्ति से अगर बचें और अध्यापक को जितना संयमी और तपस्वी और मेहनती होना चाहिए उतना, वही हमारे भारत की परंपरा रही है, तो हम सच्चे अर्थों में अध्यापक तभी बनेंगे और समाज के लिए एक मार्गदर्शक के रूप में देखे जाने की स्थिति में तभी आ सकते हैं। यही चीज मैं आपको शेयर करना चाह रहा था। बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद मुझे इस मौका देने के लिए। नमस्ते।
बहुत बढ़िया, आपने माता वैष्णो देवी विश्वविद्यालय की बात की तो मुझे तुरंत ट्रायडिक हार्ट ऑफ शिवा याद आ गया, जो मुलर ओर्टेगा ने किताब लिखी है कि जब तक जो बुद्धि है, बुद्धि नीचे आके हृदय में स्थित न हो तो कोई काम नहीं होगा। वही पे वो ख्याली पुलाव, यही वितंडा, यही चलेगा, यू नो, विवाद, वितंडा, एक दूसरे को काटना, the sharp intellect like a knife slicing through, you know, your so-called opponent, but वो हृदय में जाएगी जो उसकी हम कहेंगे जो प्रतिभा है, वो जागृत होके फिर वो हृदय में स्थित होगी, फिर आपको कोई विचलित नहीं कर पाएगा, यू नो, आप स्थिर रहेंगे और आपके यहाँ से एक सकारात्मक सोच निकलेगी। हालांकि वी वुड लव टू हियर डॉक्टर संजीव चोपड़ा, ही ऑल्सो हैड्स ए ही इज अ क्यूरेटर ऑफ a very wonderful literary ongoing platform called VOW, Valley of Words, Dehradun. Dun is a valley, but I call it WOW. Wow. So every week he has a new discussion. Last week's was on Light of Asia by Jairam Ramesh. Ideologically agnostic, but intellectually stimulating. Go ahead. Sir, unmute yourself, sir. No. We can't hear you. Dr. Chopra, we can't hear you.
Is that?
Oh, yeah. That's good. Okay. That's good.
No, you see, frankly, this has been a conversation which I'm learning a lot because the past 36 years I've been an administrator. And so one has looked at things bit differently. So for the next one or two days, I'll be listening, and maybe tomorrow evening I'll offer some comments. But I've enjoyed understanding, you know, the entire concept that have come up today. This is something which I realize after 36 years of being in the IAS that this is an area in which we were never taught. We were never, you know, we've all been looking at very, very material things. In fact, the entire way the administration is structured is all based on GDP, it is based on roads built, it's based on, you know, on nutrition, it's based on how much food we have produced, how much food we've distributed. We have not really looked into the aspects which you all have talked about. And therefore, for me, it's been a very learning experience. So I will not be able to comment much today, but I have enjoyed the conversation and I'll be enjoying the conversation tomorrow as well. Thank you very much, Professor Makarand, my very dear friend, for bringing me in. The conversation with Jairam is on Sunday. It's not past, so those of us.
Oh, good. I'm wondering. We also want to do one on that book. It's a very important book. It's a biography of a book.
It's a biography of this poem, which is really fantastic. In fact, what I never realized was, you know, how many languages it's been translated in. And I, for one, you know, it's been translated in Punjabi as well. Three times in Punjabi, and the last translation in Punjabi has now been retranslated into English, and that happens to be my grandmother's sister's great grandson who's done it. So I didn't know all this. So I mean, the moment you read anything, so one thing suddenly comes out that everything is so connected, and in administration have only looked at roads and GDP and water supplies and things. So I think there's a lot to be learned, even at this stage. Thank you very much. I mean, I've enjoyed
Thank
being
you.
Part of this.
I was only going to say, don't forget roads also connect us. So yes. Both physical roads and intellectual roads. All I wanted to say is just talking to you, I'm going to propose for Labasna courses that we do a lecture on gross dharmic practice, GDP redefined. Gross dharmic practice, what Anuradha ji just mentioned,
yes,
at the
yes.
basis of gross domestic, you know, produce, product and all the other, if you keep dharma as the base, what happens? What happens to administration? What happens to economics? What happens to, society.
Is a, if I could get into a debate here, see, that is basically a problem. The problem is that, you know, we built ourselves on the Weberian concept of bureaucracy, which is a very impersonal bureaucracy. Now, Dharma and the Weberian model is entirely different, and it's a total odds. So we will need to, you know, deliberate and discuss and, you know, get a lot of inputs on that, because the model of bureaucracy that we are following derives from one, Max Weber, and second from the Napoleonic codes which he had. And the concept of Dharma is very, very different and very, very profound. So I don't know the answers yet, and I don't know how this will happen. We might even end up creating a lot of confusion, because, you know, especially in an economies of scarcity, which we are currently dealing with. So, I mean, I don't know, but I'm willing to learn, and I would like to hear from Anuradha ji and all of you.
All I'm saying is there's room for one lecture on this, so that the people's minds are jogged.
Sure. That's what
could I just say something, please? Then, so thank you very much, Ajit ji, for your interest in the idea. So already there on the for quite a few years now, and so what I'd like to represent the dharma is one called code. And the code for me represents collective oath for development and excellence. So the very idea of dharma implied the knowledge of satya, which was the ideal, the implication of that or the application of that through rita, and the results, which is the best, which is brihat. So all these three ideas are caught. And if we create the acronym code, we've created already an acronym code for that. And my student is doing his PhD on the Brahmacharya Ashrama Dharma. What would be the code? And that's a project that I'm doing at IIT Kharagpur also, that if we had to have a, you know, these codes at an institutional level, what would it mean? A student of mine has been working around it in a village in Bihar to see that, you know, what would be the codes if we had to have codes? So like in the Gross National Happiness Project, they've identified 9 domains. So I've also identified Navaratna for the code. So all those key ideas, where the concept of code, or rather the dharma, plays an important role. So Varnashrama dharma, you know, different dharmas like that. And I think what is important is to be able to operationalize these terms in an acceptable manner. Because I had to go through the ethical committee at the institute, and the moment they saw gross dharma practice, they were all saying, you know, this is religion, and how will these students react? I said, it's nothing to do with religion. In fact, another term for dharma, another acronym for dharma could be a framework of optimized conscious action. That is what a dharma is. In the application of GDP, of gross dharma practice, I'm referring to dharma as optimized, the framework of optimized conscious action. For that, ideals have to be brought back. So we cannot, let's say, do away with the, you know, the Varna Vyavastha, for example. Now there is the anti-party to this whole, the arrangement of, you know, Brahmana, etc. They try and say we need to do away with it. As my understanding is, there is that we cannot do away with something that is intrinsically true. That people have temperaments that are more knowledge-oriented. People have temperaments that are more, you know, management-oriented. People have temperaments which are creative-oriented, and people have temperaments which are service-oriented. And what Sri Aurobindo adds to this entire discourse, he says that because every individual is a representation of the cosmic Purusha, all these qualities must be incarnated within the individual. So if the individual is doing a task where you have to teach, you have to live up to the Brahmana Dharma, teach in the best way possible. If you then have to do, if you're in a managerial situation in life, you're playing that role, you have to incarnate the best qualities of a Kshatriya. If one has to do a job of, you know, a Vaishya, then you have to incarnate the best creative and productive natures. If you have to then do something of a Shudra to serve, at that point, if one says, I want to manage, the task at hand will be disrupted, because it requires a certain, there is a need, is addressing the need through one's attitude. So I think if we can bring this back, and I think the reason why bringing in an idea of GDP in today's context is so important is because we are revamping the education system. Just like when the Gross National Happiness was decided as a policy, national policy, it had to percolate into system, into the entire national syllabi, so that every system was then catering to that. So we are at this incredible moment of history, civilizational history, where we are rethinking our education. So if we can conceive of this framework of GDP as a parallel marker, I'm not saying it is the only marker, let it be a parallel marker of how dharmic, in the true sense, how tuned towards ideal, by ideal, it is something we will collectively evolve. So we can get, you know, the intellects of the country to think together. What do we mean by the best student? What do we mean by the ideal teacher? What are collectively some ideas around? What are the values? What are the practices that we imply when we talk of dharma? And if that is taught at a younger age, you know, a few things are taught, then we can look forward to a whole generation that can probably have different values, possibly, you know, have different parameters of measuring their own success. So it would not be in terms of how much money did you get, but how much of excellence were you able to express through your work. I think that kind of a parameter would uphold our system towards its own perfect, towards its own potential.
You know, we are running out of time. I'll have to close it here, I'm afraid, but this has been a very rich, because I tell you why. You know, the Cisco WebEx creates links for a particular span of time. So what is going to happen is very soon we'll be cut off and we'll all have to again rejoin on another link. If that happens, I think we'll just call it a day. It's 6 o'clock already. I'll hand it over to Rajvichi and everybody's welcome tomorrow. If we get cut off, we get cut off. Thank you very much. We'll meet tomorrow. Sir, Rajvichi.
Chairman Sahab, आज का जो मुझे खुशी इस बात की है कि आज का जो ये ओपनिंग सेशन रहा है और जो उसके बाद अनुराधा जी का टॉक रहा है, ये अपने आप में इट हैज़ बीन वेरी एनरिचिंग काइंड ऑफ एन एक्सपीरियंस एंड इन फैक्ट सो मेनी पर्संस फ्रॉम आउटसाइड इंडिया आल्सो हैव जॉइंड. मुझे सबसे बड़ी खुशी हमारे सामने जो दो बैठे हुए distinguished participants हैं, प्रोफेसर अनिल तिवारी एंड डॉक्टर संजीव चोपड़ा. उन दोनों का मैं आभार व्यक्त करता हूँ. आई एम रियली थैंकफुल टू यू एंड आई थिंक योर प्रेजेंस एंड योर इंटरवेंशन विल एनरिच द डिस्कशंस फॉर द नेक्स्ट टू डेज ऑल्सो. सो मोस्ट वेलकम सर, बोथ ऑफ यू. मुझे लगता है कि वट एवर वी हैव डिस्कस टूडे इज बेसिकली, इफ आई समराइज, इज that we should learn something to come out of the shadows of others. And if we come out of the shadows, therefore that will perhaps encourage and create a desire to be self, and to be self-governing and self-ruling, self-disciplining. So that is what Swaraj also means, that we must self-discipline ourselves, that we must develop the qualities of self-rule. Now, self-rule, in fact, has been explained by these speakers today. Mostly, I would say that we will have to go back in the sense, what can we give to the world
with
a livable world, to make it a humane world? Because India can offer a lot in removing conflicts, in resolving conflicts, and the world can learn from us. We can also learn in other areas from the world, right? But at the same time, as Professor Tiwari was saying, ki keval dimag se sochoge to dil ka kya hoga, aur agar dil se nahi sochoge to dimag ka bhi jo direction hai wo badal jayega, aur wo jo dimag se sochne ki keval hamari parampara jo world ne dali hai, अब मैं कह सकता हूं कि जो वेस्ट ने डाली है, कि केवल केवल सेल्फ इंटरेस्ट से सोचो. और एक बात जो मैं आज तीनों लेक्चर्स से सीख पाया वो ये कि डेवलपमेंट के भी हमको मायने और दिशा और दशा पुनर्निर्धारित करनी पड़ेगी, क्योंकि बहुत से ऐसे मॉडल्स हैं जो आज के हमारी समस्याओं का निदान नहीं कर पाए हैं. चाहे वो ग्रोथ मॉडल हो, चाहे वो रीडिस्ट्रीब्यूटिव जस्टिस का मॉडल हो, चाहे वो कम्युनिस्ट मॉडल हो, चाहे वो कैपिटलिस्ट मॉडल हो, कम्युनिस्ट मॉडल तो ऑलमोस्ट कोलैप्स ही हो गया, उसके बाद भी जो कैपिटलिस्ट मॉडल है, जो ग्लोबलाइजेशन मॉडल है, उसमें भी बहुत सारी समस्याएं आ रही हैं और हम दोबारा से नेशनलिस्ट यू नो प्रोटेक्शन की तरफ बढ़ रहे हैं, लेकिन वो भी कहीं हमको पूरा छुटकारा हमारी समस्याओं से नहीं दे रहा है। इसीलिए मैंने शुरू में कहा था कि अगर हम वैचारिक रूप से स्वतंत्र चिंतन करेंगे, स्वतंत्र मंथन करेंगे, तो शायद दीनदयाल उपाध्याय के नतीजे पर पहुंच सकते हैं कि हम समाज को और व्यक्ति को एक दूसरे के खिलाफ खड़ा ना करें। कोई एक व्यक्ति है जो, कोई एक विचारधारा है जो व्यक्ति को केवल महत्व देता है, व्यक्तिगत स्वतंत्रता को महत्व देता है, और दूसरा कहता है कि नहीं, समाज इज सुप्रीम, सोशल यू नो द ओनरशिप इज द ओनली सॉल्यूशन। उसने भी क्या किया, को सोशल ओनरशिप में इतने टुकड़े हो गए कि लगा कि ये तो बेकार की मॉडल था। इसलिए उन्होंने कहा कि हम एक ऐसे विचार की ओर जाएं जहां पर हम केवल आर्थिक या भौतिक विकास का जिक्र ना करें। आर्थिक और भौतिक विकास की ओर अगर हम केवल बढ़ते रहेंगे तो हमारा नैतिक विकास, हमारा सांस्कृतिक विकास, हमारा मन बुद्धि और आत्मा का विकास कैसे होगा। विराट चित्ती की बात जो हम करते हैं, और अनुराधा जी ने एक बात बहुत अच्छी कही जो मैंने भी कहने की कोशिश की थी कि जब तक हम अपनी एजुकेशन पॉलिसी को भारत से जोड़ेंगे नहीं तो शायद हम कहीं वैचारिक स्वातंत्र की ओर नहीं बढ़ पाएंगे। या जो आत्मनिर्भर भारत है, आत्मनिर्भर भारत के लिए वैचारिक स्वातंत्र जरूरी है। आपने तीन बातें अनुराधा जी कहीं, एक आपने कहा कि जो निर्भर आत्मनिर्भर और आत्मभर, मुझे लगता है कि बहुत ही सुंदर वर्णन था कि हमको कहीं ना कहीं निर्भर से आत्मनिर्भर और आत्मनिर्भर से आत्मभर की ओर बढ़ने की आवश्यकता है। बहुत बहुत तो आपका धन्यवाद। और आपने जो नई एजुकेशन राष्ट्रीय शिक्षा नीति है उसके जो विशेष विशेषताएं जो आज के हमारे इस वैचारिक स्वातंत्र की ओर हमको ले जाने वाली हैं, उनकी ओर आपने ध्यान दिलाया। मैं उम्मीद करता हूं कि ये केवल पेजों का शोभा नहीं बनेगी जैसे पहली बहुत सारी शिक्षा नीति दब करके रह गई। अगर ये इम्प्लीमेंट होती है तो शायद हम कुछ अचीव कर पाएंगे। अगर इम्प्लीमेंट की जगह केवल नारेबाजी में ये फंस गई तो उससे भी हमको कोई बहुत लाभ होने वाला नहीं है। और इसलिए यहाँ पर जो एकेडमिक्स है उसका बहुत बड़ा रोल होता है। एकेडमिक्स को पहले इस राष्ट्रीय शिक्षा नीति को खुद आत्मसात करना होगा, और जब तक हम उसको आत्मसात करके आगे नहीं बढ़ाएंगे, सरकार की तरफ देखने की बजाय हम खुद उसमें जब तक इन्वॉल्व नहीं होंगे तो उसका लाभ हमको मिलेगा नहीं। प्रोफेसर सिन्हा और प्रोफेसर चतुर्वेदी ने नए आयाम हमको दिए और उन्होंने कहा कि ये जो सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंट गोल है ये भारत की जो सोच है पुराने से लेकर आज तक, उस सोच का ही एक परिणाम हमको याद देखने को मिल रहा है। सर्वे भवन्तु सुखिनः, ये सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंट गोल का उन्होंने जो एक लिंक दिया, आई थिंक इट वॉज ए वंडरफुल काइंड ऑफ एक्सप्लेनेशन बाय प्रोफेसर चतुर्वेदी। डॉक्टर सिन्हा ने कहा कि अगर हम वास्तव में एक डीकॉलोनाइजेशन की बात करते हैं तो डीकॉलोनाइजेशन शैल हैव टू बिगिन फ्रॉम विद इन। और अंत में मिस्टर चेयरमैन आपका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद जो आपने इतना समय भी दिया, और समय के साथ साथ जो आपके इनपुट्स हैं उनका तो कोई खैर पहले से ही कोई जवाब नहीं है, और ग्रॉसली आपका इन्वॉल्वमेंट डिस्कशन में रहा, आपने पूरा समय दिया, इसके लिए आपका भी धन्यवाद। जो हमारे डिस्टिंग्विश स्कॉलर्स ने यहाँ पर पार्टिसिपेट किया, प्रोफेसर चतुर्वेदी, प्रोफेसर सिन्हा, डॉक्टर अनुराधा, आप तीनों का बहुत बहुत आभार, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। और मैं तो फिर से कहूँगा कि अगर आपके पास समय है तो कल भी और परसों भी आप हमारे डेलीब्रेशंस में शामिल हों, कहीं ना कहीं आपको भी कुछ मिलेगा और हमें भी कुछ मिलेगा आपकी प्रेजेंस से। तो आप आए, अगले दो दिनों में भी। इस के साथ ही मैं आप सबका पुनः आभार करता हूं और अपने सभी अध्येताओं का जो यहां पर आए और अपना समय दिया, उन सभी अध्येताओं का भी मैं बहुत आभार व्यक्त करता हूं और उम्मीद करता हूं कि वो अगले दो दिन भी इसी तरीके से उपस्थित रहेंगे और इसमें भागीदारी करेंगे। धन्यवाद।
धन्यवाद राजवी जी, आपने बहुत अच्छा कहा अंत में, और अब हम लोग कल मिलने की कोशिश करेंगे। थैंक यू ऑल, हैव अ गुड इवनिंग।
नमस्कार सर।